Wait, you have a TV?
No, I just like to read the TV guide. Read the TV guide, you don't need a TV.
Everybody, it's Ken Reed, TV guidance counselor. I don't know why I'm good morning Vietnaming today, but that's how I chose to speak, and sometimes it even surprises me. Welcome to the show. It's Wednesday. It's TV guidance counselor day officially in the world over and internationally. I think world over is internationally. I meant to say intergalaxy. Is that a thing? I don't know. Anyway, feeling a little punchy today. I've been traveling a lot. Today's episode is perfect for feeling punchy. My guest is comedian Mark Gallagher. Mark is a Boston-based comedian, actually north of Boston. He's a North Shore guy, but really, if you're not from here, that doesn't make a difference, but he's North Shore. It does make a little bit of a difference. I think the reputation of the North Shore across the United States is pretty vast. But I won't get too much into that. Mark's really funny. He's an incredible weirdo, which is a high compliment. Makes some really funny videos and web content stuff that I will link on tvguidancecounselor.com. He's also hugely into the same things I am, horror movies and comics and all that kind of stuff. Performs at a lot of Gary Summers' Northeast Comic Cons, which I perform at or am usually at in some capacity. So be on the lookout for his next appearance there. But you will enjoy our conversation. So please sit back, relax, and enjoy today's episode of TV Guidance Counselor with my guest, Mark Gallagher.
TV is my friend, and it has been always there for me in time of need.
Mr. Mark Gallagher, how are you, sir?
Good, how's it going?
Good, thanks for trekking down to the house.
Yeah, I love this place. This is really...
I thought you'd like, we have a very similar aesthetic and hoarder-y nature, I think.
Yeah, I unfortunately on my end, I'm coming here, I'm jealous because I'm like trying to get rid of as much stuff as I can just to make my life more simple.
So am I. This is actually a real slim down.
Is it really?
Yeah, it's bad. Well, my thing is that I mean, none of it's junk.
And not at all. Not one piece in here is junk.
I like to get stuff. I kind of rescue a lot of things either for nothing or for like dirt cheap.
Mm-hmm.
And then, so I like them to go to good homes. So yeah, I won't just like sell them or throw them out. I'll give stuff to people, but,
right.
Cause I'd rather someone like is excited to have like the whatever weird thing that I have in here. But,
well, that's very honorable.
Yeah.
Of you.
Well, makes it easier. But yeah, and this room is one of the crazier rooms because I kind of tried to keep most of the junk in this room.
Well, part of the thrill of it is finding stuff for cheap to begin with.
Oh yeah, the obtaining. Yeah.
Yes.
Do you have the same thing? I get this sometimes where I'll see a record or a movie or something that I own, mm-hmm. but it took me forever to find, and it's like a dollar, and you just kind of want to buy it again just for the thrill of it.
Yeah, I've done that.
You've actually purchased it?
Doubles of things just because.
I haven't gone that far except for like a few, there's a few comic books, like the first comic I ever bought, whenever I find a copy, I buy it again, and some magazine stuff. But yeah, I have my brain tells me to do it, but I don't.
Yeah, it's a weird thing. Like I remember when Briscoe County came out on DVD,
yeah.
I paid, this is embarrassing.
$79.99?
You're going to put this online, aren't you?
I am.
Do you
yeah.
put this podcast online?
Yeah. I go online. Yeah. I climb up. I have a, for people that don't know, I have a big tower behind my house. And I take the tapes for each episode. And after the thing that sucks is I have to wait for a lightning storm. And then I climb up to the top of the tower and I just pin the tape there. And that's how people get it.
Well, that's, you know. All right. Well, here you go, public. I paid, I think, $100 for that when it first
When it was out of print or you bought
No.
Full
retail. The day it came out.
Best Buy?
I think Bull Moose.
Okay.
It was like the midnight launch.
Yeah.
It was bad.
But like, that was a show people wanted for years. I mean, it was so hard to find.
Yeah.
And it was at sort of, it wasn't the complete beginning of TV on DVD.
Mm-hmm.
I think the first big box, bleh, I don't know why I did that. First big box set I done buy was Grand Ole Opry in 1961. Got it on hay bales. It was just burned in the side of them hay bales. It was great.
It's a dead format. It's a,
the hay bale.
Yeah,
yeah. But there's like some younger kids are starting to embrace hay bale television series again.
Yeah, yeah. They wear really dumb hats.
They do. Yeah. They do. But I bought the X-Files. The first season was like one of the first things to ever come out on DVD for a whole season, and that was like $199 when it first came out, which seemed reasonable. And I remember I saved up and bought it, and I was broke. I had no money anyway. And
that's
it was
when.
Just,
when I bought a lot of the stuff I own, I had no money. I shouldn't have been doing it, you know. My life probably would be better if I had put money to the side. But...
Well, they've done psychological studies that the more money people have, the less interested in physical or, like, tangible goods they are.
Uh-huh.
Because it just doesn't really mean anything, because they can kind of get anything anytime. I have found that the better I've done in life and the less poor I've been, the less I am, like, trying to obtain stuff.
You're not desperate.
I guess I'm not looking for that thrill or trying to like stretch what little money I have into something I enjoy, maybe.
But you also know that if you ever do want it, you can go get it.
Right.
It's like, oh, I got the cash.
That's a good point, yeah. So that's probably why as well. I've gotten rid of a lot of TV on DVD if it's streaming because a lot of them don't have extras. My new rule is, unless it's a movie that's so obscure, there's no way this is going to be streaming or I'll be able to see it again. If the DVD or Blu-ray or whatever doesn't have extras, because those are never streaming, like those will be lost, like a commentary or something, I get rid of it.
Yeah, that's Netflix really. I love Netflix and just a lot of those streaming services, but so much of my collection is on there.
Yeah.
And I look at it and I'm paying like $7 a month, $8 bucks a month. And I spent thousands of dollars on the stuff that anyone can watch now.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, my biggest splurges, I think, were there used to be a place called Deep Discount DVD, which I don't even think is a thing anymore.
Uh-huh.
And they used to once a year have a 50% off sale for like 2 days. And you could get coupons and stuff too. And this was in like 2001, maybe.
Mm-hmm.
And I was ridiculously broke and super depressed. Should have been definitely medicated.
Yeah.
And I like basically maxed out a credit card. Like I spent like $3,500
really
on a credit card. And I got like a crate of DVDs.
Wow.
It was, that was not good. Yeah.
Yeah. If I had a credit card at a younger age, I probably would have done a lot of stuff like that.
Yeah. One of the worst instances of credit card damage I did was I was 18, and there used to be a bookstore called Waterstones, if you remember that. There was one in the North Shore Mall, there was one in Back Bay, and there was one other one.
I must have been in it, because I go to the North Shore Mall a lot.
It still exists in England, but it's not. It was very much like a classier Barnes & Noble.
Mm-hmm.
It was like, we just do books. It was not they didn't have like a coffee shop or any of that stuff. And they were going out of business.
Mm-hmm.
And all the books were 90% off.
Oh.
90% off cover price, all books. So I went in. I had to, this is actually horrific. One of them, I had a station wagon at the time that I paid for with band money that I earned when I was in my band.
Nice.
I filled it with books and had to come back to get the other half of the books I bought.
So you were that guy to them.
Yeah.
Ah, that guy's back.
Yeah. It was bad. I mean, I did get some cool books, but I was like in debt for years because of it. I think I still have some of them.
Really?
Yeah. That was bad. That was bad.
I know. Yeah. And then the other, there are a lot of ebook readers. You can just, all of those books you can fit in the palm of your hand now.
Yeah.
It's very weird. We just didn't think that was going to happen.
You never thought that
happened. It's a dream come true.
We were just talking about that earlier. Like I have every issue of Fangoria on a little SD card that I have in my tablet, and I read them way more now because I don't have to trek down to the basement or whatever. And you know, I can go on an airplane with 200 magazines with me, and I couldn't feasibly have done that otherwise.
Right.
And I love that. That's, that's great.
Yeah, it's very cool.
Like, you hooked me up with a Raspberry Pi that has, every Nintendo...
Every game.
Super Nintendo Genesis game.
Yeah.
Yeah, and it was great. I was like, this would have been a wonderful dream when I was 12. Like, someone was like, we'll give you a pack of cigarettes that has every game on it ever.
It's a legitimate fantasy that I've had.
And that if you bought all those, not even new, like if you just bought them all used now, that's like $10,000 worth of video games.
Oh, at least. And there are some of those rare games on there that you can probably sell for $10,000 a cartridge.
Oh, yeah. Or ones that just never came out. Like, those are the ones, too, where they didn't manufacture it for whatever reason.
Yeah, like the prototype. types.
Yeah, have you ever seen the old horror, because Mark's a fellow horror movie guy. Have you ever seen, it's always weird when I say that and I'm looking at the person, they're like, why have you, but then because we forget that people are listening that aren't us.
Right, there are people out there.
There was a bunch of Wizard Video, Charles Band's.
Yes, yeah,
they
yeah.
tried to do video games for a while, and they did a Texas Chainsaw Massacre Atari game.
Oh, I know that game, yeah.
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 And there's a Halloween game for like Commodore 64.
I didn't know that
64.
Was them.
Yeah, that was them. That was them.
So that's why that happened.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Yeah, there was like three or four of those that never came out. They were horror games. They're terrible games.
Well, there were a lot of Atari, like what Nintendo did, because the video game industry collapsed for a little while. What Nintendo did was license their cartridges so they had to be reviewed by the company. Before
yeah, you needed
they could
the seal
out.
Of approval.
Yeah, and before that, one of the reasons that Atari collapsed was because... people were making anyone could make an Atari game.
Oh, yeah.
So there was a lot of junk that came out and it just got flooded.
But I was able to, you know, back to hoarding, I was able to get Atari games for like $1 each new at service merchandise. Which
oh,
was like,
man.
They just had bins and bins of them, you know, all kinds of stuff. I remember my dad bought a dirty Atari game called Custard's Last Stand.
I know, yeah. That's a very messed up game.
I don't remember what was dirty about it.
Well, he's a rapist in that game.
Is he?
I mean, I've never played it. I've seen videos of it online, but as far as I can tell, he rapes Indians.
That's
in
what
that
the point of the game is?
I think so, yeah.
I remember my dad playing it and loving it, so now I'm a little bit disturbed.
This is great. No, Ken, no, yeah. Don't. It's not. I'm a history buff.
It's not for kids.
Yeah, I'm a history buff.
I thought it was about custard.
Yeah.
That's not how my dad talks, but, you know, in this scenario, I decided, you have kind of a high voice like that, and, you know, like that custard.
Very, very Tony Clifton.
Yeah, my dad's Tony Clifton. he'd be it, rape it. That's what he would say. So you've chosen an issue here from March 17th through the 13th, 7th through the 13th, 1998. I assume you didn't pick March because it's very similar to your name.
Actually, that is why.
Yeah, everyone's like, my nickname's March Gallagher. Everyone calls me March. Marchy March, that's my name. But if you put on an album, you could call it The Ides of Mark.
I'm going to write that down
yes,
right now.
Yeah. Or we should write a horror movie called The March of Cain.
Okay,
and
yeah.
And it's about all right, here's what it's about. It's about Cain, the biblical Cain, coming back from the dead somehow and just murdering everybody on St. Patrick's Day.
Oh, I like it.
Yeah, yeah. Has to stab them in the back. That's how he kills them. It's just a ton of frat dudes. And
holiday tennis. Horror films are very fun.
Yeah, I mean, what do we have for St. Patrick's Day movies aside from Leprechaun?
Yeah, if you want to even go there. I never
Halloween 3 almost is
the
same.
Oh, yeah,
movie.
With the lucky, what's the...
Silver Shamrock.
Silver Shamrock, yeah, that song. How does that go?
Oh, did you really want me to sing it?
Do it.
8 more days till Halloween. And then goes down to
right.
Silver Shamrock.
Right, right.
Yeah, or Rawhead Rex is kind of a Celtic horror movie.
I've only been, people have only talked to me about it. I've never seen it.
Movie's terrible.
Is it?
But the book is cool. Yeah, it was one of the Clive Barker had like 3 movies made of his work before Hellraiser.
Uh-huh.
And they're all awful.
And so that's a Clive Barker thing.
It's Clive Barker,
oh, okay.
Yeah. Yeah, one of them's called Transmutations. That's really bad.
Yeah.
Yeah, there's a lot of really awful adaptations of Clive Barker books.
I revisited Hellraiser recently.
What were your thoughts?
Holds up.
It's great.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's fairly timeless
and really great.
Yeah.
And terrifying.
Yes, legitimately. There are a lot of movies. I like watching horror movies. I don't get scared by them anymore.
Yeah.
Unlike when I was a kid, that's why I liked them so much. It was because it legitimately terrified.
You got a thrill?
Yes.
Yeah.
But now it's just fun to look at the makeup and stuff like
right.
that. There are some still pretty creepy moments in Hellraiser.
Oh, absolutely. Like the reconstituting Uncle Frank and, and Uncle Frank speaking
and
of
him walking
rapists.
Around with like no skin.
Yeah. And like blood all over his suit. Yeah. That movie is horrific.
Yeah.
It bothered me that they made sequels though, because part 2, although it has some cool stuff in it, the great thing about Hellraiser, which is Paul Reiser's Hellraiser stage production.
Oh, would you mind if I killed you?
Yeah,
could I kill you?
I wrote all the music for it. It's fantastic. Now I want to see that Hellraiser. but it was, they never said they were demons. There was no heaven and hell. they were just like interdimensional, kinky, weird perverts, basically. Yeah. And some people were like, it was like ultimate S&M weird perverts, essentially. Uh-huh. And then in part two, they're like, no, they're demons from hell that used to be human. Right. And I'm like, nah, now you've made it less, much, much less interesting.
The second one is it's in the asylum, right?
Yeah.
That is a pretty good movie.
It's good, but it's just that one piece bothers me.
There's always something in a movie, just that little thing. It's like a sentence, and it can either make or break a movie because they justify the story they're trying to tell you.
Yeah, like in Halloween 2 where they make Laurie Strode his sister.
Yeah.
Why? There's no need for it.
Just because.
It's terrifying that it's a human animal you can't reason with who has no agenda. He's just murdering people for no reason.
Yeah.
And once you add a reason there, it's not as scary anymore.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe that's why they do it. I don't know.
That's part of the problem with the remake, the Rob Zombie remake.
Yeah, don't humanize him.
Yeah, why'd they do that?
Yeah.
The second half is kind of, like, it's not bad, I guess, for whatever they're trying to do with it. But
it's like, oh, he's white trash and he was abused. Isn't it tough?
Yeah.
Yeah, it's like, we get it, Rob Zombie. You're from Haverhill.
Yeah, I know. Well, that's the thing. Like, if you go by that first half, it's like, oh, I guess I'm supposed to be a murderer then, too.
Yeah, because you're from, like, Haverhill, Salisbury, Amesbury kind of area.
Yeah.
North of the city. And you were saying that Jeffrey Donovan from Burn Notice may or may not have babysat you as a child.
Yeah, if I'm to believe my mom, which he is my sister's. We have different fathers, my sister and I.
He's Jeffrey Donovan.
Yeah, totally different.
There's one guy who fathered everyone in Amesbury.
he's my sister's uncle. And from what I understand, my mom went to high school with him. And supposedly he babysat me. I don't remember.
So your sister's father is his brother?
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
All right.
And don't look into it. I think he's kind of a shady character.
Oh, Donovan? You think so?
Not him. The
brother. Yeah. I believe it because did you watch Burn Notice?
I saw a few of them because I thought it was cool, my relationship with him.
Yeah.
And also big Bruce Campbell fan. Yeah.
It was a great show. It was like a really good version of the A-Team. But whenever he had to go undercover as a scumbag, he always did Boston accent. Uh-huh. And I assumed he had to be doing someone he knew's specific accent, which must be his brother.
It's probably his brother.
Yeah, like there's one episode where he goes up to this guy. He goes, yeah, guy. What's that phone? Is that a razor? And it's just, I'm like, yeah, he's doing somebody he knows. There's no reason.
Yeah,
yeah. But I loved that show. He's a great martial artist, fine actor.
Is he legit martial artist?
Yeah, he is, yeah. I saw him in a play. In Boston called Burn This, weirdly. And
was it before or after the
It was during Burn Notice. He came and did it was during the Boston Pride weekend. Uh-huh. And it was a gay play. but it was a really funny play, and actually John Malkovich had played the part that Donovan was playing, had played it when it was in New York.
Uh-huh.
So John Malkovich was there sitting behind us. Which is hilarious. That's... And there was a girl in the front row who was just like a Burn Notice super fan who had like a Burn Notice shirt and all this stuff. And Malkovich is kind of talking to the guy he was with. And he goes, you know, there are people here who don't know Jeffrey from his Hamlet. And so Rachel's sitting next to me.
He's just the king of pretentious sentences.
Oh, yeah. Rachel's sitting next to me, and he's right behind her. So she's trying not to laugh. And he's saying all kinds of crazy stuff. And then he goes, I guess he's on some sort of television program.
Oh, come on.
And this girl turns around, and she goes, it's called Burn Notice. And it's awesome. And Malkovich leans in, and he goes, tell me about it. And so this girl, she has no idea it's John Malkovich, goes, and then like does the whole plot of Malkovich, and he goes, oh. And that was like his whole reaction. It was great.
That's it.
And because it was a comedy, you know, it's like a dark comedy. And because Malkovich had been in it, he knew all the lines. So before mm-hmm. every funny line, he would start laughing.
Oh, man.
So before Donovan started saying it, you'd hear like, ha, 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 ha. And it was a really weird way to watch a play.
Yeah. If I ever go see that, I need to find out and sit right in front of him.
Yeah. I would just go to everything with John Malkovich. Yeah.
Is he a local guy?
He lives in Harvard Square.
No
so
way.
So everybody, well, not everybody, a lot of people I know have stories of encountering John Malkovich.
I gotta run into him. I'm in Harvard Square a lot. I haven't
he
run
was,
into him
One
yet.
Day I was with a guy who doesn't do comedy anymore, but we were standing just talking on the sidewalk when we were going to the comedy studio.
Uh-huh.
And John Malkovich came by, and this kid was like, oh my God, John Malkovich, Mr. Malkovich.
Yeah.
And he goes, just walk with me. I like to keep moving. Walk with me. So we're like walking with him, and And we get to the studio, and this kid goes, oh, we're comedians. We're doing comedy in the show. Did you want to come check out the show? Which is a dumb thing to say. But Malkovich goes, oh, absolutely not. And then just walked away. It was fantastic.
That's a pretty good answer for...
Yeah, that's the correct answer, I think.
Yeah.
Another friend of mine who's just like a dozy, really easygoing guy was putting butter and salt on his popcorn at the movie theater that used to be in Harvard Square. Mm-hmm. And the whole time he's doing it, he hears just someone behind him going, and Charlie's like, oh, sorry, man. Did you need the salt? And he goes, yes! You're so mad. Yeah. Encounters with Malkovich. That's
so he stuff. Sounds exactly like what I assume he would be in real life.
Yeah, I think it's probably anything you think about Malkovich is true. I think all of that's true.
That's great. That's good to know.
Yeah. So this particular issue is very Pacey heavy. We have Pacey's on the cover from Dawson's Creek, which is immediately why you...
That's why I went for it. I was like, I want to do something 90s, and that kind of popped out. I remember loving that show. The first season, just, it was like the best thing on TV
to me.
Was
it because, so to put this in context for people who maybe either are too old for Dawson's Creek or don't remember it much, because I don't think it really re-airs anymore. It's not a show like Gilmore Girls that people have really revisited and a cult has grown around it.
I wonder if it's one of those shows where they maybe... whoever owns it doesn't really care so much, because I think the DVDs are really, really cheap.
Probably, like Mill Creek or something like that.
Yeah, like one of those.
Well, So Kevin Williamson was the hottest, I mean, physically, wow. Yeah. I know, hottest screenwriters in Hollywood for about a year, because mm-hmm. he wrote Scream, and then 8mm he wrote. And the only movie he had written before that had been produced, you may know this, Brain Scan.
He did that.
He did Brain Scan.
Oh, man.
And he wrote that when he was working at Tower Video.
So that's Eddie,
Eddie Furlong.
Eddie Furlong, yeah.
Unless I'm confusing him with, who wrote Seven?
I don't know who wrote Seven.
Yeah, it might be confusing him with that guy. But he wrote Scream. He definitely wrote Scream.
Yeah.
And that movie was incredibly innovative. Everyone was like, wow, this is, for the first time, people are commenting on a horror movie, and they know they're in a horror movie, and the dialogue's really great. So... he was kind of like a golden boy in Hollywood, and he mm-hmm. did that movie, Teaching Mrs. Tingle.
Yes.
That was originally called Killing Mrs. Tingle, and they had to change it because of Columbine.
Good decision.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But so he created Dawson's Creek for TV, and everyone mm-hmm. thought he was going to do like a horror show. And instead, he did this show about teenagers in a small North Carolina seaside town.
They end up in Massachusetts at one point.
Did it take place in Massachusetts and was just shot in North Carolina?
I think it might be that way.
Okay,
yeah.
All right, yeah. And Dawson was like a nerdy film nerd.
Right.
Everyone talked like they were 35, which people are used to now, but was very strange then. Because before that, really, most shows about teenagers were adults playing teenagers. And this was actual teenagers, but talking like adults. It was kind of the opposite. And I was excited for the show. I love teen angst. And in interviews, he said his biggest influence on that show was James at 15, which was a show shot in Boston from the 70s that I loved. And I just couldn't get into it.
Yeah, I, for whatever reason, it just clicked with me where I was at the time.
So you were a lot younger. You were like 13, maybe?
Yeah.
And they were like 16?
Yeah.
So they probably seem cool.
I'm not in high school yet. They are. And it's just one of those things, like, before you're in high school, you have all these fantasies of what it's going to be from movies and TV.
Right.
And it's like, oh, I want to go to that high school.
Yeah.
Also, I want to sound like them. Now, I do not want to sound like them.
Yes.
But at the time, their vocabulary was just so broad.
They seemed so smart and cool. Yeah. And Katie Holmes was so cute. Michelle Williams was, like, totally crush-worthy.
Right.
And I was intrigued because John Wesley Shipp was in it, and I was a big Flash fan.
Yes, that was another thing. Flash Dad.
Former guest of the show.
Yeah. That's Wesley Shipp. I call him Flash Dad.
Well, he's Flash Dad now, but he was just Flash for a while. Like the original Flash.
So, great show, the original Flash.
Yes. The biggest problem I had with that was that they didn't give him any supervillains, really.
Yeah, they did that with a lot of, like, 90s superhero TV, like Lois and Clark. It was all, like, businessmen.
Except the episodes with Mr. Mitzel Pitlick.
Yes.
Who,
Howie Mandel?
No, it was Michael Pollard. Michael J. Pollard played Mr. Mitzel. And it was perfect.
Uh-huh.
People that don't know Michael J. Pollard, he's a character actor that is kind of... he's a bit like Todd Barry. In a weird way. But he was actually, Todd Barry would be a great Mr. Mitzel Pitlick.
We should pitch get the word out there.
But they, it was always businessmen or like evil developers or that kind of stuff. I imagine it was just budgetary.
It definitely, but it was a big complaint I had at the time, even watching it. I would watch it regardless because I'll watch anything Superman. It's a cripple, like it's a condition that I have.
Well, sometimes it pays off, like with the 90s WB show.
Yes, but that's one of the only times it pays off.
It didn't pay off any other time. Superboy, the syndicated series that they shot at Orlando, or 1988 Ruby Spears Saturday morning cartoon. Do you remember that one?
All I remember from that is in the intro, he puts his arms out and he spins around and goes into the into the pavement. That's it.
You know what was great was the 1990 Superman arcade game.
Yeah, that was pretty fun.
Side scroller where you can be red Superman or blue Superman.
I play that once in a while at Weird's Beach.
Yes, yes.
At Funspot.
That is also where I play that game.
Yeah, yeah.
Whenever they have that and they have an 89 Batman movie game.
They're right across each other.
They're often broken.
Yes. Yeah.
So it's always a crapshoot when I get up there if that's going to be broken or not. And
another one that's broken there all the time is the Terminator shooter.
Oh, yes. Yeah, yeah.
Yeah.
The Judgment Day. Have you ever played the Aerosmith shooter game?
Yeah, where you shoot all the CDs and the cats.
What a bizarre game that was. Yeah, very weird.
Well, just like anything else, it gets so big, they just find any way they can license it.
Yeah.
And, they had an arcade game, and they have a roller coaster.
But the Aerosmith arcade, the plot of the game is you're in, like, a 1984-style dystopian future with, like, a fascist government.
Right.
And Aerosmith is gonna save them.
Yeah.
And you win by shooting CDs and shooting cops.
Right, right.
It's a weird game.
Very weird, yeah.
All right, so let's jump in here on Saturday night, 8 o'clock on March 7th, 1998. I was about to graduate high school the next month that year.
Ooh, it's exciting.
Yeah, it's very exciting.
At 8 o'clock, and I put this on, I just wanted to watch a half hour of this because there's something I liked at 8:30.
Yeah.
Hercules.
Hercules, The Legendary Journeys?
Yes.
Yes. Kevin Sorbo. This is Herc and Lolias find themselves in a parallel world. Each saddled with lookalikes of the other who acts very differently. Meanwhile, Zeus appears to be dying. This has Lucy Lawless.
All right.
Doing a Xena appearance. I love her.
She's great.
She's funny and stunning.
I think this was around the time because Xena came out pretty close to after their Hercules was like a year after or something like that.
Yeah, yeah.
So I think both shows were going on, so it was like a fun little crossover.
Yeah, and then you had like Jack of All Trades, speaking of Bruce Campbell, which was a spinoff.
These are all Sam Raimi shows.
Yeah, too. Sam Raimi and Rob Tappert, and they all produce those shows. I think that's a good call. I'm sort of intrigued by a special called An All-Star Party for Aaron Spelling, celebrating a television dynasty. And you didn't get a lot of these weird shows in the 90s. This was a very 80s style thing. And it's Hollywood salutes the 40-year career of the prolific producer behind more than 50 TV series. And we have Farrah Fawcett, Jacqueline Smith, Dynasty's Joan Collins, Linda Evans, John Forsythe. We have Heather Locklear, who he calls his lucky charm.
Oh, man.
She was in a ton of his shows. He must have loved A Return of Swamp Thing. But
yes, a big fan of that.
I'm going with Bloopers.
Was that a thing? Did people really appreciate TV show creators around that time, or was he one of the only big
names?
There
was very few. It was Aaron Spelling. Everybody knew his name, and everybody knew Sherwood Schwartz, who created The Brady Bunch and Gilligan's Island, and Gary Marshall. Those were like the three people probably knew.
Yeah.
You didn't really start getting that sort of showrunner, show producer stuff till like Aaron Sorkin.
Mm-hmm.
And Stephen Bochco, he did Hill Street Blues, and I think Chicago Hope, and once he did Cop Rock, everyone was like, nope,
see ya, dude.
Yeah, there were a few, but not like now, where more people know the people who created shows than know the shows. Sometimes
was Cop Rock any good? I just know everyone makes fun of it. I've never seen it.
I kind of liked it. It's out on DVD now.
Yeah,
it was an interesting idea. It was not done in any sort of irony or tongue-in-cheek at all. It was completely 100% sincere.
Mm-hmm.
And that, I think, is what threw people off. Like, I think if it had been a comedy, people would have been okay with it. But it was like watching Hill Street Blues or, you know, one of those kind of somewhat heavy police dramas.
Yeah.
And then just them singing.
Oh, it's a crazy idea because you imagine there are so many people you have to go through before something hits air. So you need, like, three people to be like, thumbs up, sounds good.
That just points to how powerful he was in Hollywood at the time, because he had so many hits under his belt that he was in a position where it could be like this show. And they're like, whatever you want, man, it's going to work. And I guess it probably, the people who were greenlighting shows at that time were really old. And they're guys that remember how big like Broadway was. I mean, Broadway's big now, but that used to be the prominent thing, you know, and just musical theater and radio shows and how that was very much a part of entertainment history. Mm-hmm. So it probably made sense on paper to them.
Yeah, yeah.
But was not a hit at all. Yeah, not a good show.
But you went with Bloopers.
I went with Bloopers. I was always up for Bloopers. And this is a surprise by Tom Arnold gives his wife the opportunity to meet for the first time the infant child her parents have adopted. Okay.
What's Bloopery about
joke.
That?
He's playing a practical joke on her. Comic outtakes from TV series include Fired Up, which I don't know, Caroline in the City, Babylon 5, Another World, and Days of Our Lives. I do love a blooper. Just this morning, Rich and I were laying in bed watching news bloopers, and we laugh at nothing more than news. Like, I can't.
Yeah,
I
news
hurt
bloopers
myself
are
laughing,
great.
Hurt myself.
I love when there's a level of, like, with infomercials, when they're trying to sell something that's just bullshit, and then it just completely falls apart on them.
Yeah.
And I like that with news anchors too. They're just trying to pitch just garbage at you. Like there's a classic one where somebody's rowing a canoe.
Oh yeah.
Have you seen that?
Yep.
Yeah. And then the guy's walking. It's like 1 foot of water right behind him.
I
love that
and
kind of stuff.
I love just watching people. Like, I feel bad for them because they have to, if stuff goes wrong. Yeah. They have to just talk.
Right.
And they constantly talk. So it's very easy to say the wrong thing. Like, they're constantly swearing. Like, one of them this morning, the guy instead of fire truck said fuck truck. And like that kind of stuff, which, you know, it happens to us. We're just not on TV at the time.
Yeah.
But it's so funny.
Yeah.
It's just so funny. Or I really like one where like inappropriate dickhead anchors make like a sex joke.
Right.
And nobody thinks it's funny.
Yeah. It gets really uncomfortable.
Oh, there's one we were watching this morning where this woman, two favorite ones. The first one was not quite that thing. It was a woman and they were having that awful banter and, she was talking to the weather guy and she goes, well, it's Wednesday, it's hump day. And oh no, he said it's hump day. And she goes, well, let's hope it's a dry hump. And then the other anchor goes, well, and then everyone got uncomfortable, which was fantastic.
Yeah.
And this was my favorite, that I saw today, was this woman was doing like a dog adoption segment and, you know, she's like kissing the dogs and whatever. And they throw it to the weather guy and he goes, get a room. Probably the most action you've seen in years.
Oh man.
And then it's nothing. And he goes, wow. Well, I thought it was funny. And then this goes into the, oh, it's great. It's
know, with that dynamic, that there's probably a lot of spite behind the scenes.
Yeah.
And
absolutely. And having worked at a local news station.
Oh,
totally.
Yeah. See, you've
totally
been there. Yeah.
Yeah. Which was fun. 8:30, you said you switched to something different?
Yeah, I want to watch all that on Nick.
Okay, so you were a big SNICK person.
I was, but this, I just loved sketch comedy.
Okay.
So I had to go for it.
Did you have a set bedtime?
No, I wasn't really raised.
Okay,
so
excellent.
I just, whatever, yeah, anything went.
Because I was going to say, a lot of kids that age at that time would watch all that because they weren't like old enough on a Saturday to stay up for Saturday Night Live or something.
Right, right.
But all that never really got into, was always just too young for me. Mm-hmm. I'm watching a whole hour of Bloopers, but Cops is on, which I would always watch. And The Real World's on. This is the Boston cast. This is where Genesis questions her sexuality.
I saw that and I was thinking about watching that, but I was all that.
I would have watched it at, you know, at another time, absolutely, because it was on like 700 times every weekend.
And what season was that?
That was the Boston cast.
Oh,
Genesis,
okay.
Who they referred to in the promotional materials as a lipstick lesbian.
Oh, man.
Which I think is offensive. Like, I don't think you can do that.
It is pretty rude.
Yeah. No one of them ugly lesbians. She's, you know, you would kiss her like a real girl.
Yeah
it was that kind of weird. Yeah, and they filmed that season of The Real World in the firehouse, the fuck house, from Spencer for Hire.
Oh, that's
yeah, it's the
that's
same
great
building. Yeah, in the back bay. 9 o'clock. Would you go with
9 o'clock? Batman cartoon.
So let's see. Batman is on 66. This is Batman the Animated Series. Yes.
Oh, okay. Yeah. See, I wasn't sure. I didn't know which Batman it was.
Yeah.
No matter what it was, I would have liked it. I was like, is this the Adam West one? Because I know he voiced one after they did the
Super Friends. Filmation did one
In
the 70s. That was terrible.
It was bad, but I would have watched it.
It was Adam West voicing Batman, but Casey Kasem voicing Robin.
Oh, man, Burt Ward can't get a break.
No, I mean, although if Casey Kasem's going to replace you for a voiceover job, you're probably, well, now would be offensive because he's dead.
Right.
But then, you know, be like, all right, I could see if you're going to take him. You know, at least it's not Donnie Most.
Did he do the Justice for, or the Super Friends?
Some of them. Uh-huh. So some of them are Burt Ward. Some of them are Casey Kasem.
Okay.
There's really no rhyme or reason to it.
Yeah, yeah.
I did enjoy that at this time, Batman the Animated Series had been on off the air, I think, for a year or two. But a lot of markets realized it had kind of an adult audience and would air it later at night as kind of filler.
Uh-huh.
Which was kind of a cool thing.
Now, you told me this, where, what region was this?
So this is East Coast time, but it's Alabama.
Yeah, because I don't know if this was, if their programming was too different than ours. Like, I know the major channels are going to be the same, but it just seemed to me kind of odd. There were a lot of cartoons on this night.
Late at night. Well, they are one of the least educated states. In the town. No, yeah, there would be a lot of like whatever they had that was cheap in local markets.
Yeah.
They would also try and re-air stuff multiple times. So they were like, we paid for it. We can air it as much as we want.
Uh-huh.
So air it in the morning for kids and at night someone will watch it.
Yeah, yeah.
So it was a weird time before people, some people did time shifting, but it was mostly like, you know, people will watch it at night, they'll watch it in the day. For a while, they were re-airing Pee-wee's Playhouse at night in the early 90s because they were like, we know college kids want it.
So right,
it was
right.
very strange. I'm intrigued by a premiere at this time. It's mid-season replacement, show starring the beautiful Jennifer Beals, and it is called Nothing Sacred. In this one, Father Ray and the staff grow steadily more unhappy with Father Martin, who wants to close the soup kitchen and replace three of the workers. So this is a soup kitchen set drama. It sounds like they're trying to do like an ER type thing around the church.
Yeah, I might check it out now. When I was going through these, the mindset that I have is like, all right, am I going to watch what I would have watched?
Or it's kind of what you would want to watch now, which will probably mostly be what you would have watched.
Yeah, yeah.
But not totally.
Right.
Yeah.
I jumped around like that. That might be something I would check out just for irony's sake. Like maybe there's a laugh in there.
Because did you go with Freakazoid at 9:30?
I did. Yeah. You're good.
That's a good mix though, because that was a show that would appeal to adults as well. Like,
yeah.
Or the adult children in all of us.
Yeah. Was that? I know Spielberg had produced a lot of animation for WB then.
Yeah.
Was that one of his?
His name was on it, but it was the same crew that did do Animaniacs and Tiny Toons and that kind of stuff. Yeah.
And those are the guys that also did the Batman
show. Yeah. So this channel, which the UHF station likely just bought in the days before, right before the WB launched, probably bought a syndication package to air that content whenever they wanted. So that was likely why they were airing it at this time.
Well, good for them, right? I like Freakazoid.
Oh, yeah. Saturday night at 9 o'clock, you turn it on Batman the Animated Series and Freakazoid. I'm into that. I always remember Freakazoid seemed to air a lot like opposite Earthworm Jim.
Which I also really liked.
Yeah, I enjoyed that as well. That was a cool, like smart, weird show.
That was the guy that does Homer Simpson voiced him, right?
Yep, Dan Castellaneta.
Yes.
Yep, yeah. So Sunday night, 8 o'clock, what are you going with?
Sunday at 8 o'clock. Because I went crazy on Saturday, and I was like, at 10, I'm going to watch this. 11, I'm going to watch this.
Oh, yeah, that's fine.
I put South Park in there just because, you know.
Yeah, South I mean, Park. That was big.
Are you a South Park fan?
I really liked it when it first started and enjoyed it and then kind of fell off, but I'll watch an episode every now and then, and I'm always still impressed that it's basically keeping the quality up and it's still funny.
Yeah, especially with the times, because some of them are very, very crass, like the earlier stuff. But that wasn't on TV then. You know? So,
oh, yeah.
But they keep with the times. It's great. So anyway, Sunday, 8 p.m. All right. So this one, I'm going to just watch an hour of one of these movies.
Okay, so you're not watching The Simpsons.
Not watching The Simpsons.
Okay.
Yeah.
98 was kind of a low spot.
Yeah, I loved The Simpsons for probably... I watched the very first episode when it aired.
Yep.
And
I watched it.
Yeah, with the dog. Yep. And I watched it religiously for many years. But then towards the end of the 90s, it's... I don't even know if it was the show. But it's just when I fell off.
Yeah, that makes sense. I think you're not alone there. So what are the movies you're going with?
So I wasn't sure if I want to watch... This is... Don't make fun of me, okay?
Mo Money. Yeah, that started as an In Living Color movie.
Yeah, yeah. I remember I loved that sketch. I know you're not a huge In Living Color fan.
Not at all.
Which I have revisited. It does not hold up, but at the time it was a perfect show for me.
It was innovative at the time and was unlike anything else that was on, so it was kind of interesting. But yeah, it's terrible.
Yeah.
Terrible. It's so offensive. And
that's
I'm not,
the problem. Yeah.
I mean, I'm not offended by, like, if you're good enough at comedy, you can tackle any topic.
Right.
But that show was just so lazy.
Very much
so. Like, the head detective
and
the handyman is the one that just drives me crazy, because it's like, this joke literally is that this guy's handicapped. It's not about how people react to him. It's not about how he's like, you're not doing anything. You're literally just laughing at a handicapped guy.
Yeah, and I didn't know that I was laughing at a handicapped guy when I was like 10.
Well,
11,
you're 10. You know what I mean? Like, they're like 30-year-old dudes.
Yeah.
Come on. Be a little smarter about it.
But I love, because of that show, I loved anything that Damon Wayans did outside of that.
Okay.
So I was a big Mo Money fan.
They really put, he eventually did become a movie star, but there was a lot of failed starts.
Yeah.
And they put him in a lot of stuff that was like, this is going to do it for him. And Mo Money was one of them. And it did not do well.
No.
It's not a very funny movie. Was the other movie Lucas?
No, it was Lethal Weapon 2, which is not embarrassing.
That's not a totally bad one. There is a Discovery Channel show on called Tarantulas and Their Venomous Relations. Giant hairy spiders and their relatives are observed.
That could
be fun.
What
it says, yeah.
That could be fun.
So I am actually going to watch a made-for-TV movie starring Melissa Joan Hart.
Uh-huh.
Because Sunday night and Monday night for years were the made-for-TV movie nights.
Okay.
And kind of before Lifetime really picked up that mantle.
Yeah.
And we don't have it now, but 98 it was sort of falling off because cable was definitely taking up the slack. This is Melissa Joan Hart stars in Silencing Mary. Melissa Joan Hart is convincing as a student crusader determined to expose violent crimes on campus. Hart plays Mary Stewartson, a school reporter who stumbles on a major story after her roommate is raped by the school's star quarterback. After interviewing the dean of students, played by Peter McNichol of Ghostbusters 2.
Oh, big fan of that guy.
Mary uncovers similar unreported crimes and a conspiracy of silence among teachers intent on protecting the school's reputation and its prize athlete. Corin Nemec is in it, of Parker Lewis Can't Lose.
All right.
And what a way ahead of its time story, where people still talk about this stuff and it's still a problem. I mean, we're talking almost 20 years ago, and I'm also all for anything that knocks down athletes, especially college or high school athletes.
Yeah.
Fuck those guys.
Peter McNichol is so underrated. I feel like not enough people talk about him. He's amazing in Ghostbusters. He's probably the best part of that movie, of Ghostbusters 2.
Are you not counting Bobby Brown?
Oh, I'm sorry. Can my brother get one of those?
Yeah. I mean, On Our Own's maybe the best song ever written. Talk about Viggo, the master of evil, trying to mess with my boys. That's not legal.
That song's hilarious because right after the chorus, he just tells you the plot, which a lot of those movie tie-in raps did.
Yeah.
There's a Ninja Turtles one, the same thing.
Go Ninja, go Ninja, go.
Oh, no,
the one
first
with turtle
one.
Power?
Yeah.
Teenage Mutant Ninja Power. Yeah, there was one that's like, then there was Shredder, and the Foot Clan came, and the kids came in, and the turtles fought. Like,
they just tell you the plot.
Yeah.
So it's like, oh, I can't get to the movies this weekend. Let me just listen to the single.
I love movie tie-in songs that clearly were not written for the movie, but then will shoehorn in something from the movie. I feel like On Our Own is one of those from Ghostbusters 2.
Right.
My favorite one being We Don't Need Another Hero, Beyond Thunderdome.
Oh, yeah.
Because we all want to live beyond Thunderdome. Like, it just doesn't make any sense in any way in the rest of the song. It doesn't belong in there. Yeah, it's great.
That doesn't happen enough, I think, anymore, where musicians get pulled in to make a... Like,
well, I think that the
Huey Lewis.
Yes. You know. Yeah. Back in time.
Yeah.
Well, I think that we don't need that to promote anymore because of social media and soundtracks.
Right.
People don't buy full albums anymore either. They buy singles. So it seems unnecessary in a lot of ways these days.
And unfortunate. That's too bad.
The 90s was really the pinnacle of all that. I mean,
yeah.
There's so many songs that were hits from movies that I think probably did the movie more service, especially the Batman movies. Like, you had Kiss from a Rose, the Seal song. That was on Batman Forever, I think.
Yeah.
And Hold Me, Kill Me, Kiss Me, Thrill Me, that U2 song, that was in one of the Batman soundtracks.
I think it was the same one.
Yeah, they had a ton of hit songs off that.
Yeah.
Yeah, you know what? And Offspring had a hit with a cover of Smash It Up, the Damned song that was on one of the Batman soundtracks.
Okay.
Yeah, and the Crow soundtracks had like all the, there was a ton of soundtrack. Romeo and Juliet had the Cardigans. It was huge.
The first Batman was all Prince.
It was all Prince songs.
Which is incredible.
It's fantastic. Yeah.
And they're all good too.
Yeah. They're great.
He didn't just half-ass it. Those are some really good songs.
Electric Chair is one of the best songs he's ever done.
Yeah, and what's great too is a lot of times you hear that crap, you're like, oh, gee, like the first Spider-Man movie.
Yeah,
I think Macy Gray, is that her name?
Okay,
She's in that. She's in the movie for
I
no reason.
I try to walk away and I choke, I stumble.
it's weird. It's out of place, but
my whole world crumbles when you are not there.
With the 89 Batman,
yeah,
they work for whatever reason. Those songs really work well where they're placed in the movie.
Didjectic music, is that the word I'm looking for?
I don't know that word.
There's diegetic.
You know why? Because I never became Dawson.
That's true. I think that someone will correct me if I'm wrong. But yeah, one of them means like music that is within the scene, so it's coming out of a radio or something.
Yes.
And then music that exists where the people in the scene are unaware of the music.
Okay, so someone will like punch a jukebox and then a song play and then they'll dance or fight to it or
like
whatever.
In Near Dark where the Cramps play while they slaughter everybody in that bar. Yeah. That would be diegetic music, I think.
Oh, that's it. Well, I learned something new.
Yeah, there you
go.
That's
awesome.
Because when you think about it, we accept score like it's nothing.
Oh, yeah. It's just...
But if you think about the concept of that, it's very weird.
Yeah.
There's just music playing all the time that the people are unaware of existing.
Right, and it's like borderline like classical music.
Yeah,
you know?
It's a weird... I mean, obviously it's important in a film, but it's a strange piece of the fabric of a movie or television show.
It's very manipulative, too. There are clips of people put online where they pulled... John Williams music out of Steven Spielberg movies.
Yeah.
And it's hilarious because they put in actual sound effects. So like when E.T. goes onto the ship, take away the John Williams score and you just hear like E.T. shuffling quietly.
Well, have
into
you seen the one where someone did the Bowie and Mick Jagger dancing in the streets?
Oh,
video
it's
with
hilarious.
All the music. It was really funny. Yeah. I do enjoy those.
Yeah.
I do enjoy those. So what are you going with at 9 o'clock?
9 o'clock. So we're on Sunday, right?
Yep.
9 o'clock. All right. So, I was like, is it X-Files? Is it Daria? I probably would watch those at the time, but now, because I'm sure you know the answer to this, what the hell is Team Knight Rider?
Team Knight Rider was their attempt. They made a couple attempts to bring Knight Rider back.
Uh-huh.
And the first one was a made-for-TV movie called Knight Rider 2000 that took place in the year 2000 and was Michael Knight's son.
So that year 2000, that's when they first invented the laser gun, right?
Exactly, yeah. It was from, I think, 1990 or 91, and it was in the future of the year 2000.
Yeah.
Huge failure. It was a made-for-TV movie as a pilot, never went from there. Team Knight Rider was a similar thing where it did not have Hasselhoff in it because he was out on Baywatch, but he was riding high in 98 because Baywatch was the most watched show in the entire world, syndicated across the entire world. And so what he had done was he produced this, I believe. He also tried to do a Nick Fury, Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. movie where he played Nick Fury.
Yeah, I used to watch it a lot.
That was a pilot for a series that never came out.
Okay.
But Team Knight Rider was essentially going to be about the car with a new group of people who use Kit. So it was no Michael Knight, just the Knight Rider car Kit. No,
do
the
they get
people.
The guy, what's his name?
Oh, yes, Mr. Feeny.
Well, then I'm all set.
Yeah,
I'm fine.
Yeah, yeah.
I'm fine.
Not a good show, though, sadly. I'm intrigued by a thing in here that is a movie on Showtime starring John Voight called The Fixer. I fix things for the rich and influential, and now I have to fix my life even if it kills me, which sounds just like Ray Donovan, which he started for Showtime 20 years after this.
Yeah, that's weird.
Isn't that weird? Very, very strange. Monday night, 8 o'clock, would you go with?
Oh, well, I was, that's on at 10. See, I went way ahead of myself
that's
on all
right.
this.
That's all right.
But yeah, I wanted to watch Tracy Takes On at 10.
It's hard to navigate.
Can I watch Tracy
Takes
On?
Did you get TV Guide when you were a kid?
Yeah, we didn't have a subscription, but my mom would buy it every week at the grocery store because she did the crossword puzzle.
Okay, so she splurged. It was a little indulgence.
Yeah, because it's way cheaper if you subscribe, isn't
it? Yeah, it was like $1.50 around that time. When you subscribe, it'd be like a quarter an issue, basically.
She wasn't doing that.
She didn't have all that money at once.
No, yeah, yeah. I think that might have been the problem.
Did you have cable?
We always, for a long time when I was really young, we had a lot of stolen cable. So yeah. I had HBO.
Nice.
When I was really young.
Yep.
And so I got to see like Kids in the Hall when it was on HBO.
Yep.
And I was like 5 years old watching Comedy Def Jam.
Yeah.
Because I told you I wasn't raised.
That's right.
So that's when I wanted to do comedy. When
you
I was,
were
like,
raised,
five.
But you were raised like yeast.
Yeah, yeah.
it fed you a lot of shit and then you just grew and got some gas. And
from the warmth of the TV, just kind of like bloated.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah, that's fair.
Yeah, that's a good analogy.
Yeah, you can have that for your tombstone.
I remember when like we had stolen pay-per-view, right? So we would have to go down to whatever the pay-per-view channel was because they just loop these movies.
Yeah, it was
all
sometimes
day.
Channel one.
I forget, or it's like in the real deep numbers.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
So we go to whatever channel has the movie, and you have to hold this button down on the cable box and shove a pin in there.
Yeah, 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 yeah.
Yeah, that's how I watched a lot of stuff.
Yeah, I remember I built the black box.
Uh-huh. So is that what we had, a black box?
Yeah, basically. Well, no, you sounded like you were jimmying the actual cable box.
Yeah, yeah.
But you could build one that essentially does that. Like it has, but you basically build in a pin, essentially.
Yeah, yeah.
But I built a black box when I was a kid, and I remember in 1988, The Lost Boys came on pay-per-view a year after it had been in theaters. It wasn't on video yet.
Yeah.
And it just aired 24 hours a day. It was like the Christmas Story.
That's how
it
would
do. Over and over again. And I would just watch it. Over and over and over again. That and Revenge of the Nerds 2, both of which I had seen in theaters, I just watched on pay-per-view that summer over and over. Like it would end and I would watch it again.
Right. Revenge of the Nerds 2 is like one of those tropical comedies. There were a lot of those.
Nerds in Paradise.
Yeah.
I actually have it's a little bit covered back here, but there's a promotional standee from Nerds in Paradise.
Oh, I see that.
Just the top.
Yeah.
Features a hit song by 38 Special in the opening credits.
I love that
movie.
Take
Me Back to Paradise. Yeah. Well, it was written by the two guys who created Growing Pains.
Oh, okay.
They wrote the second Revenge of the Nerds. And ghost written by the guy who wrote Bill and Ted.
Oh, what's Richard?
No, it's
the other guy?
Ed Solomon.
Solomon. Yeah, Ed Solomon.
Yeah.
Wrote Men in Black.
Yep.
The Super Mario Brothers movie, which everyone hates. I love. I love that movie. Yep. I don't care. No excuses. It's like one of my favorite movies.
I don't know if this is common knowledge, but I found out I had Paul Dini on the show, and he wrote the Double Dragon movie.
Did he?
Yeah, but I think uncredited.
Oh.
I don't know if everybody knew that, but he said that on the show.
I remember really excited to watch that movie, and when it came out, I didn't really have any taste.
Were
it
you
was
a
like,
big Scott Wolf fan from Party of Five?
Must have been, yeah. And it had the name Double Dragon, so I'm like, I'm all in.
Yeah.
I'm watching this.
Did
and
they
loved
have
it.
A Bodo in it?
A Bobo.
A Bobo. That
and
was
they
it, yeah.
did. It was a guy that got mutated.
Okay.
And then turned into this weird, giant, muscly thing.
A Bobo.
And I'm pretty sure they called him a Bobo in that.
I keep waiting for the Streets of Rage movie.
Soon.
Yes.
I'm sure.
I want to see someone fight on roller skates.
I bet you there's some weird, obscure, like, Japanese production.
I'd believe it. Yeah. They're, Streets of Rage.
Yeah. I'd be all about that.
Was a better game than Double Dragon?
Double Dragon was really hard.
Yeah, it was difficult. I did beat it though. Was it the Shadow King? Is that the guy's name? And it turned out to be one of their actual brothers in the game. That was like the big plot in the Double Dragon game.
Oh, I don't remember. I beat Streets of Rage a lot.
Yeah.
Because that I had a Genesis and I was just constantly like I had the four games that I owned.
Yeah.
So I could I knew them all back and forth.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
But yeah, I don't remember.
What were they? So Sonic.
Oh, see, yeah, okay. So what were the games? I think I've told you about this one before. The Haunting.
Yep. I've played that on the where you just go around.
You haunt a house.
Poltergeist.
Yeah, Poltergeist. Yeah. You haunt. It's a.
That's a fun game.
Yeah, it's a great idea for a game.
It's
too.
Really hard.
It's pretty hard.
Yeah.
You just have to scare people out of many homes until I guess they're broke and they can't buy any more houses.
Yeah, and if you don't, you get sent to hell.
Yes, and you have to eat or step on ectoplasm to...
So you can get back out, yeah.
Yeah. So what other games did I have?
Echo the Dolphin.
No, I didn't have Echo.
Eternal Champions.
X-Men. The X-Men game.
Which sucks.
That, It's pretty bad.
Yeah.
The second one was a little better.
It's not as bad as the Nintendo X-Men game, which is one of the worst games I've ever seen.
Now, video games have consistently been, since I was a little kid, like $50 or $60.
Yeah.
So when imagine when you're like 8 years old, it takes a long time to get $60, you know? So I remember blowing my money on that X-Men game.
Yeah.
Brand new. Oh,
I bought it. At Child World on Route 1 South in Saugus, it came out.
That sounds like a very disturbing name for a store.
Child World?
Yeah,
I loved Child World. It was the best toy store on earth. There's still there's a couple of buildings on the North Shore that used to be Child Worlds that are still there that have weird, they were built to look like castles. So
that's pretty cool.
If you know by the Liberty Tree Mall, there's a, it was a, Linens and Things for a while, and then it turned into Sports Authority or something like that. It's across the street from the Liberty Tree Mall.
Yeah.
That was a Child World.
Okay.
And if you look, it has these weird round windows because it was built as a castle. There's a guy on YouTube who used to work in that Child World in the 80s and had a camcorder, which was a total novelty.
It sounds creepy again.
Yeah. and just pictures, just videos of kids shitting. No, it's, he filmed like them setting up the Christmas displays and like all his coworkers, and he put them all up on YouTube. So it's like all these North Shore of Massachusetts dudes with mullets and mustaches working at a toy store in the mid 80s, setting up like Eternia.
That's
really fascinating.
Yeah, that's something I would watch.
And training videos as well, which is always exciting.
Nice.
Yeah, but I bought that game. It's like for some reason, the camera angle is from above, like in Zelda, so everyone's like really squat.
And they
terrible.
Don't look like the characters that you're playing. They're just, it's just like four or five messy pixels.
But that's all, like having an X-Men video game was huge.
Yeah.
Like the cartoon hadn't even been on yet.
Mm-hmm.
Having anything based on a comic book that wasn't a comic book was the biggest deal on earth. Like
right.
It was really rare.
Right.
That's why, and then one of the reasons the Flash show was so exciting. Like I couldn't wait for that to come
out. Yeah, I would just gobble up anything comic book related. I love the Swamp Thing show.
Oh yeah. Do not bring your evil here.
Yeah. What's Dick Durock.
Dick Durock,
right?
Yeah. Got to do his own voice in that.
Yeah, because he was Swamp. He was just, there was never any other Swamp Thing, right?
He was Swamp Thing in both movies and the TV show. He was a stunt guy. He was a stunt guy in a ton of stuff. But yeah, they dubbed his voice in both the movies.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
Yeah, Dick Durock was, so anything superhero related, but I would just watch garbage. Like a lot, if you could go back and revisit this stuff, it's bad.
Oh, it's really bad.
Lois and Clark, for example.
Lois and Clark was bad.
I can't bear that show anymore.
Do you remember the Generation
DMK.
X pilot that Fox did?
All right, my grandfather was in the hospital.
Okay.
And I had to fight my parents to not go.
So you could watch that?
Yeah.
Oh, that was not a fight worth fighting.
No, again, like I've got no taste. So the fact that it exists is enough for me. I remember there was a character that it wasn't Mr. Fantastic, but he had like stretchy arms or something.
Yeah. And Emma Frost was in it.
Okay.
She ran the generator. I remember weirdly, now that you say that, I remember watching the premiere of The Critic in the hospital with my grandfather, who was like
dead. I need to let you know I love you. Yeah. Okay.
Yeah. Like he wanted to watch Hawaii 5-0 or something, and then he passed out from morphine. So I was like, no way, I'm watching The Critic. And
yeah.
I was like, oh geez. Oh, go grandparents. Yeah.
Oh, I know.
My grandfather was in a really bad nursing home for a while because my grandmother had stolen all his money and had put him in like the cheapest possible nursing home, and it was in Revere. It was right next to a strip club called the Squire.
I know about that place.
Yep. And where my sister, when she was a teenager, convinced her friends, she got them all fake IDs and would drive them there on amateur night and would make them dance, and they would take part of their prize money.
Wow.
She wouldn't dance. She just orchestrated it.
Wow, does she own her own business now?
She sadly does not.
Okay.
No. Yeah, but that was very, very industrial.
Yeah.
But so my grandfather was in there, and I remember we went to visit him, and he had a roommate, and this crazy old guy insisted I take all these pairs of long johns. He's like, the boy needs long johns. Take these. So I was like, okay. And my dad was like,
a growing boy needs his long johns.
He gave me like this stack of old wool 1940s long johns.
Uh-huh.
And I was like, I don't. I was like 12. It was so awkward. And my dad was like, just take them. So I took them. And I remember they were all folded nicely. And we drove back home. We got out of the car. And my dad just opened the garbage bin. And then we just put them in there. And I put like this stack of like neatly folded long johns in the top of this garbage bin. And I still feel bad about it.
Well, there's, I mean, if you see something like that in the trash, you always imagine there's a very sad story behind it.
Oh, absolutely. My dad used to buy all kinds of exotic pets because he was poor when he was a kid, and, he bought a tarantula. And I don't know if you know that tarantulas have no skeleton.
I didn't know that.
So when they fall, they explode.
Oh.
And they're...
like from how high? Very, very high? Or...
no. They're basically like, if you dropped a light bulb, how hard would you have to drop a light bulb for it to shatter?
Yeah, like 2 feet.
Not that far.
Yeah.
And so my dad would show it, you know, people would come over and be like, hey, check this out. And it fell and just exploded, right? So we had,
I had no idea that could happen. That's...
yeah, we basically had a flat tarantula. Like it was like, it just... like
oh, he
a,
lived after that?
No. Okay. But it with the body.
Yeah.
And so my dad, it was garbage night, and my dad just went out and just put it on top of the garbage. Like he opened the can lid and just put it right on top of everything. So the next day, we saw the garbage man come out, and he opened the lid and screamed. Like, couldn't stop screaming because he just thought there was a giant tarantula in the garbage.
Yeah.
And he didn't know that it was dead. Yeah.
I lost a iguana to – he got stuck in a Christmas tree, and Christmas was over, and he got put out. And I he was my best friend, this iguana. He was so
– so your first pet?
No, we've had a lot of pets with tragic conclusions.
Yeah.
But I just loved it. Like those kinds of animals aren't usually friendly.
No. Well, iguanas can be sort of dog-like. We had like 10, about 10 iguanas over the years.
So you've been through this before. Yeah. I came home, from school, like got off the bus and I saw the Christmas tree. And I saw him like just dead on top of him. Like, whoa,
jeez.
That was rough. That was
cause he must've got thrown out with it. And then the elements got him.
Yeah.
Yeah,
because it's winter. He's done.
I remember we had this iguana and it died. I don't know how it died, but it turned black.
Okay. Because
when they die, they just turn black.
Oh.
It was really weird.
Yeah, yeah.
And so,
yeah, now that I think about it, he was darker than...
yeah. And so I had to go in. I was maybe like 6 or 7 and like pick him up. Like no one wanted to touch it. And they're like, is he dead? And I just went in there with my bear. I was like, yep, he's dead.
Done.
You couldn't... if someone were like, I'll give you $1,000 to pick up a dead iguana now, I'd be like, fuck you. I'm not doing that. And then we had a baby iguana. And it ran under the washing machine, and my dad lifted the washing machine up trying to get it out, and it slipped and just squished it.
Oh,
oh, it was terrible. It was just awful. I'm very protective of my pets now, and I have no lizards.
Yeah, I think that's the thing. You need to have very small, like, I don't want to say worthless, but like disposable pets when you're a little kid.
I think that's important because it teaches kids responsibility.
Yeah,
and like... this will sound terrible, but I think kids do need to understand loss.
Yeah.
Like death.
Yeah.
And it's a good way to do that. But
it is,
not that much. Like we had guinea pigs that ate their children in front of us. And we had, you know, jacks and chameleons. And I remember I had a turtle, and I was out on the back porch with this turtle, and a hawk flew down and grabbed it and flew away.
Man.
Just came down. It's like, just grabbed him.
It's the saddest and funniest image.
Yeah.
Like if you own the pet, it's very sad. But if you are just like watching it in your peripheral, a hawk coming down.
Oh,
taking...
yeah.
I hear stories about people losing their cats and dogs like that.
Yeah.
It's not my cat or dog. So when I hear about it, I'm like.
There's a big problem with that now because in Massachusetts, a lot of cities have done this and it's a great idea, but they figured out that if you get a falcon or a hawk nest and you put it on your city hall, you don't have to pay for rodent control because they'll literally eat every rodent within like a 5-mile radius and basically just keep your town free of vermin. And it's really, really effective and totally organic, and you don't have to put poisons down or all this stuff. But it's been so effective that they're really breeding a lot. Like we have 2 or 3 that fly through our neighborhood, and they'll sometimes grab people's dogs or small dogs or cats and that kind of stuff. It's not their fault.
No.
But that would be horrific.
They're impressive animals too.
Oh yeah. They fly and they like turn on a dime.
Yeah.
The dogs, whenever they see them, they just sit down and look up with their mouths open like, whoa. That's why we have big dogs.
Oh, good idea. Yeah.
Yeah. They can't be carried away by any sort of animal.
Yeah.
I remember my dad accidentally killed, well, he didn't accidentally. We were some friends of ours. Of my parents had a farm up in New Hampshire, and there was a rooster that was really vicious. Which, think about it now, they may have had like some kind of cockfighting ring. Thinking about these people, but they sent my dad in to feed the chickens, knowing it would attack him, and they thought it would be funny. But he just kicked it,
and
it basically exploded.
He doesn't have a good track record with animals.
He kicked this rooster so hard it literally just like blew up.
Wow.
It looked like, you know when they show
feathers everywhere?
Yeah, like, you know when they show like a watermelon getting shot with a bullet?
Yeah.
And it blows up? It was like that, but with a rooster. And then they were so mad at him. What were you doing? But he got all cut up. Like, the thing really attacked him.
Yeah.
And he was like, what? That thing would attack me? You guys are dicks.
Yeah.
That was a lot of animals problems.
I've been chased by geese. They can, it's
scary. Break your arm.
Yeah. They're vicious.
They got weird little teeth.
Yeah, that's a scary thing.
Yeah. They're strong.
Yeah.
Yeah. So swans? Swan will mess you up. They are real strong and they're very vicious.
Yeah.
Yeah. And in England, it's illegal to eat swan unless you're the queen.
Well, who's eating swan?
The queen.
Okay.
Like swan pate.
So there must be like a black market of swan in England.
Maybe,
then.
Of black swan.
Yeah, black swan.
DVDs of black swan.
Black swan, black market.
Yes, exactly. So where are we? Monday night, 8 o'clock?
Monday, 8 o'clock. Where are we? So what did I... Monday, 8 o'clock. I'm going to watch Sightings.
Sightings was the trashy version of Unsolved Mysteries.
Yeah.
I always say it's Unsolved Mysteries without the rapists.
Yes.
That was a show I absolutely loved. It used to be on Friday nights. It was an hour block with X-Files before X-Files moved to Sundays at this time. And this episode of Sightings, let's see if we have an explanation here. I do want to mention that you passed up watching Ally McBeal, which has a guest starring role from Tracy Ullman.
And Peter McNichol was also on
that show.
Yeah.
Sightings that night, they do not tell us what that episode is about. I assume it's probably crop circles.
Yeah, it always was.
Yes.
Or ghosts. It was Unsolved Mysteries had more of a broad range of topics that it would cover.
Yes.
Sightings was always aliens, ghosts, UFOs.
Yes, absolutely. There is a show that I don't want to watch, but I do enjoy the title of. Claws, The World of Crabs and Lobsters.
Yeah, good title.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But there is a movie on it, and I'm going to watch it all night Monday night. And it's a movie I saw in the theater. I absolutely loved. It stars Jeff Goldblum and Cyndi Lauper. And it's called Vibes. Have you ever seen that movie?
Oh, yeah.
Peter
Vibes
Falk
is
in it. It's a great movie.
Yeah.
They play psychics. It's really funny and weird. I saw it in the theater.
I shouldn't have skipped over Vibes. I would watch that.
TV Guide only gave it 2 stars, which is bullshit.
That's a very, very good show.
It's a good movie.
I watched that a lot on my stolen HBO when I was a kid.
I saw it in theaters, and believe it or not, after we record, I'll take you down to the basement.
Uh-oh.
But I'll show you my Vibes memorabilia. I have like shooting scripts.
Wow.
And I have props from the movie Vibes down there that I got for nothing. Like, I love that movie.
And you know what? It's hard to find. Like, there are a lot of movies that when you go to flea markets and stuff, like VHS, that repeat themselves over and over, like Titanic. You know?
Yeah.
Vibes is a pretty rare find.
It came out on DVD as part of MGM put out a series called Martini Movies.
Uh-huh.
And it was a weird, like, sub-label they had for a while. And the premise of it was you would watch a movie and make a drink that went with the movie. So the DVD case had, like, a weird drink recipe. So Vibes was one of those movies.
Okay.
Yeah.
What would go with that?
I forget the drink. I probably have the DVD around. Yeah. You can look it up, but it was a really weird concept.
Right.
I don't know why they did that. So I'm watching that all night. You're doing Sightings for an hour. And what are you doing at 9?
At 9 o'clock on Monday, Sliders. I'm going to watch Sliders.
I could never get into that show despite really liking Kari Ware.
Jonathan Rhys-Davies was... Yeah. I loved him for some reason.
Yeah,
he's very fatherly, grandfatherly.
Yeah, he's got a beard.
Yeah, that's all you need.
You did pass up something called Jonathan Pond's Tax Party. The financial planner offers advice on how to take advantage of the new tax laws.
It sounds like a tape you would buy, not something they would air on TV.
Like, if you're gonna call it the tax party, like I want like it to have like En Vogue on it, or something, you know, like special guests, Cato Kaelin.
Yeah, yeah,
maybe, you know. Oh, welcome. It's a tax party.
Yeah.
Tuesday night, 8 o'clock.
So, Tuesday, 8 o'clock, Buffy. No question. That was it.
Yeah. This was what, the second year of Buffy?
I don't know when. I forget when it started.
I think it started in 97.
Does it say what the episode is?
So this is after catching the gang in a series of lies, Buffy is glad to be reunited with a friend from her old high school. But could their secrets be connected to the new boy who's armed with his own stakes and too much info about someone's slaying habits?
Might be the first season.
Yeah. I think 97 or 98 was the first season.
Yeah.
Yeah. Do you familiar with the episode where the teacher becomes a giant praying mantis?
That's first season too,
yeah,
isn't
yeah,
it?
Yeah. Yeah. Musetta Vander played her. She was been on the show.
Oh, nice.
Very nice. Very good actress. I'm going to watch Roy Orbison in concert.
Okay.
I love Roy Orbison.
Yeah.
Yeah. So I'm watching that for an hour. Buffy is an hour. What do you go with 9 o'clock on Tuesday night?
9 o'clock Tuesday night. The whole reason I picked the TV guide, Dawson's Creek, I had to just because of the...
Yeah. And this episode is not a great episode. I remember watching this episode. This episode is Dawson feels the heat when Jen is visited by an old boyfriend. Joey lets off a bit too much steam at the end of a beach party and ends up in a sticky situation, and tensions between Mitch and Gale reach the boiling point.
Oh, man.
Sticky situation.
So yeah, Pacey was always punching people.
Yes, absolutely. And
again,
he was a tough guy.
I was like first season Dawson only.
Yeah.
I watched for after that. I was all done. I checked out. But that first season, I loved it. Yeah, I remember it was like every other episode, Pacey was punching someone out.
This is disgusting, but I'll share this.
Okay.
Watching the news bloopers this morning, this is 100% real. They were doing a news story about like a snowstorm, a blizzard, and people going out in the blizzard to get stuff. Because they always interview like the stray people that are kind of walking around.
Yeah.
And it's a dad and his son who's maybe like 12 or 13. And they go, what are you doing out in the blizzard? He goes, well, the only thing opens Rite Aid Pharmacy. And, you know, he did real good on his report card. So we came down to get him some hand lotion. and the news reporter goes, you could have got anything you want. You want a hand lotion? You like to have your hands moisturized? And this kid goes, yeah. It's like the weird. It's beautiful, and it's a totally real news clip.
Oh, wow, that's great.
Yeah. And the dad is, it's awful. But a sticky situation reminded me of that. I'm watching, without fail, Miss USA. I always watch Miss America. I always watch Miss USA.
I don't think I've ever seen one Miss America.
I love them. This was the year Miss USA 1997 was Brandi Sherwood. She was giving up her crown this year. And so it was a new sort of reinvention of Miss USA that year. And they were all constantly trying to reinvent that show.
Aren't they still?
They still are.
Yeah.
And it's always interesting to see what. Because it's a ridiculous concept.
Yeah.
It really has no justification behind, aside from ogling women.
Right.
And they constantly try to make it not that.
Uh-huh.
And just the ways they try to do it. And it's always hosted by just the cheesiest human beings. And for whatever reason, I just love those pageant shows.
The cynical side of me just rolls my eyes whenever that comes on. And like, you know that movie Drop Dead Gorgeous?
Yeah.
I think that's like, to me, that's my take on all that stuff.
See, here's the weird thing. We got that weird in the early 2000s, that weird fascination with the behind the scenes of those like, you know, Toddlers and Tiaras and the Honey Boo Boo garbage and all that kind of stuff. But I don't care about the behind the scenes at all. Like,
right.
I literally just like the big, ridiculous, old fashioned, dumb show.
Yeah.
Like the pageantry, the literal pageantry.
Yeah.
Is fascinating.
Right.
I love the talent portion. What the hell are they going to do? Sometimes they do like dramatic monologues, and then the next girl will be like twirling a baton, and then there's a girl who does like fire eating, and then someone who like crochets. It's the weirdest. Oh, they're fantastic. And it's a weird thing to show on a network television station in the 21st century.
And is it something like the Oscars where it goes on way too long? Like
no, it's always on time. It never goes late.
Well, good for them. That's
a very well rehearsed show.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah. So I'm absolutely watching. It was always a big deal. Plus, March was always kind of like a slow month for television, so it was nice to get those sort of pageants. And I'll watch a pageant over an award show 100 times out of 100.
Yeah, I always get excited that, like, the only thing I really care about is movies, you know? Like, I don't even care about the Emmys.
Right.
And whenever the Oscars start, I get excited, and then maybe an hour in, I'm done.
Boring. Like, even the movies, because I'm like, I don't care. I mean, you've seen me go on rants about this sort of stuff on the internet, but I hate when you apply sort of sports rules to any sort of art. So having like a winner and a loser, like I don't care about competition does not intrigue me. I don't like seeing it. I'm just like, I don't care. So when I'm like, yeah, my movie won, or like, it's great for them to be recognized, whatever, but I don't have like a stake in it. Like who's gonna win, you know?
Right. Well, it's weird too, because you can have two great actors or two great like, say it's a comedy festival and you have like Eddie Murphy Eddie Murphy and Steve Martin.
Yeah.
Up against each other. One of them has to win because it's a competition.
They're very different.
Yeah. One of them better? No.
Well, we know that, but a lot of people would say yes.
Sure. I know. It's very weird. I'm making fun of it on my Facebook.
Yeah. Saying you won the Monster Energy Drink. Yeah.
Yeah, I won the Monster Energy Drink Comedy Festival.
I think you should call it the Monster Energy Drink and Gas Station Comedy Festival because they have Monster Gas Stations, the same company.
Do they know? Yeah. See, I didn't know that. Yeah, which is really I'll weird. Have to change it.
We literally sell energy drinks and gasoline. Yeah. It's literally just the same thing.
Yeah.
It's like the stuff. We're selling, make people drink it and fuel the car.
Pour it into your tank and then into your mouth.
Have a sip. Yeah. The kind of people that drink that would do that. Like, they're the kind of people who think they're in like a Fast and Furious movie.
Yeah.
Let's somehow come up with a combination car fuel. Well, I couldn't speak. Car fuel.
Yeah.
And energy drink. And we're going to make $1 million.
I think, well, you know what? Water.
Yeah. Yeah, we'll do both. We'll do hydrogen cars.
Yeah.
Yeah. There is like...
But we'll flavor it and we'll say it's not water.
Yeah, exactly. It'll be like, it'll be Red Bull flavored water.
Yeah.
Ah, it smells like liquid Smarties and nothing natural. Yeah. I always get annoyed when... First of all, I don't like Star Wars, which is well established. But when you have people who go, Annie Hall beat Star Wars in 1977 for best movie. And I'm like, Star Wars is a children's film.
Yeah.
It's a children's film and it's a dumb movie.
Yeah.
And also Annie Hall, like, whatever one you like is fine. Like, the fact that the Oscars gave it to an interesting dramedy is not any kind of affront to a children's action movie. Not, it also doesn't mean like, so now they got to kill the whole cast.
Right.
Like, there's no consequence of
it. Well, I always say that because I don't watch sports or anything. I don't care if people do or not. But when people get really like the Super Bowl, for example, say the Patriots win the Super Bowl.
Yeah.
I always tease people that get excited about it because I'm just like, oh, so they're done?
Yeah.
Like they don't play anymore? Like, we got to start a new team? Well, no, they're just starting again next year.
Yeah.
Like, oh, okay. Well, what did they get? Like, do they win a castle or something? Yeah. Or no?
They're not going to be murdered. Does the other team get killed? Is there an execution?
Yeah, there's nothing at stake. That's why I'm not interested in a lot of sports, because it's like there's nothing. It's like the uniforms all look the same.
Yeah.
Like, the colors are different. That's it.
I understand playing a sport.
Well, yeah.
I might understand even going and watching as a social event, whatever.
Uh-huh.
I do not get the like really being into following a team for a whole season. And I don't know. I just don't get it.
I just want to go back on Star Wars, though. I do like Star Wars. I just don't. I didn't like it when I was a kid.
Yeah.
When I was a teenager, I started to enjoy it. But all that said is that movie was a disaster that just happened to work out.
Yeah, it was a perfect time, I think. It managed to distill a lot of childhood and B-movie things for the previous few decades and kind of hit at the
right
thing, you know?
And also, though, just it was a troubled movie going in. They just happened to tinker it to make it work.
Right.
Because it was an awful script. George Lucas had a lot of really bad ideas that needed to be batted down.
You've described this movie the same way I described my childhood.
Oh, yeah.
It was an awful idea and they tinkered with it and it worked out okay.
Yeah.
I'm not the biggest Woody Allen fan, but like, Annie Hall is objectively a great movie.
Oh yeah. No, it's he just fires movies out. He does two, sometimes three movies a year.
Yeah.
And maybe 25% of them are great.
Yeah.
And his stand up though, I think is like I don't think anyone has been able to do that better. Like, close. Stephen Wright
stole a lot of those jokes.
Did he? Yeah. No. Yeah. Man, I listen to that stuff.
Yeah.
Over and over again, because I think that's some of the best joke writing.
I have it on good authority that he's stolen a lot of those jokes.
Man, well, you know what? Now I believe all the Dylan Farrow stuff.
Yeah, you should. Yeah. But Phil still jokes. He'll do anything. Wednesday night, 8 o'clock. What'd you go with?
Wednesday at 8, just because this is TV Guidance Counselor and it comes up a lot and I wanted to play ball.
Okay.
Unsolved Mysteries.
Yeah, I love it.
Yeah.
You know, we've already discussed kind of the... the sightings as the low rent Unsolved Mysteries. But Unsolved Mysteries was on Wednesday nights at 8 for years and years and years.
Yeah.
This particular episode is when it's still Robert Stack hosting the show. It was not yet switched to Dennis Farina.
And I was never there when Robert Stack wasn't hosting. So I never saw any of the other...
He was not the original host, and he was not the last host.
Okay.
It was Carl Malden originally, and then Dennis Farina at the end, which was very weird. It doesn't tell us what the stories are in this particular episode, so we'll never know. But there is a great ad in here, which is the most pandering ad I've ever seen. It's for a WYBE-TV Philadelphia News special. Did the Irish discover America?
Well, the Vikings had red hair.
That's true. This night also, and I don't know if you didn't go with it at 9:30. We'll get to it in a second, actually, because we're not at 8:30. But I'm going with the movie until 9:30. I'm not going to watch the last half hour of this movie. Uh-huh. But I'm going to watch Clueless.
Clueless, yeah. It's perfect
choice.
It's
a fun movie.
Yeah.
Great pedigree behind the camera.
Yeah.
I loved Alicia Silverstone. I loved Stacey. I love the whole cast of that movie. Big crushes. I was 18.
That movie's a great time capsule.
Yeah, absolutely. I love how there's a scene where she's calling Haitians Haitians. And that's not in the script. She really pronounced it that way on the tape.
Perfect.
And they kept it in there.
Yeah. That's funny. I didn't know that.
So 9 o'clock, would you go with?
I will say
8:30, I miss Sybil, which I loved and had a huge crush on Alicia Witt, by the way.
I did write in between 8 and 9, I wanted to watch Beavis and Butthead.
Fair enough.
But at 9 o'clock, Forever Night.
Forever Night.
Yeah.
The vampire cop show.
Yes. Yeah.
Originally starred Rick Springfield in the made-for-TV movie Nick Knight.
Which is the only thing I've seen. I never saw the show. I only saw that made-for-TV movie.
The show is... okay. It was made by the... I don't know if this is 100% true, but I was pretty sure it was made by the same production company who made Highlander the series.
Okay.
And it's very similar.
Yeah.
Also, it just hit me recently that Highlander is a vampire movie.
Yeah.
It's a vampire in all ways, aside from they don't prey on humans.
Yeah.
But it's like a vampire in all other ways.
That's now I gotta do a lot of rethinking on that.
Let's get the horror out of the vampire element, and we got Highlander.
The only there's a lot of... Highlander is like a huge industry.
Which is very strange.
I know.
Is there a video game? Like a
There must be.
Like a beat-em-up video? Like there should be like a Street Fighter type Highlander game.
Yeah, it would be even if they made it now, it would be great.
It's built into the premise.
Yeah.
That there can be only one. It's a movie about a fighting tournament with swords. Why is that not a game?
Yeah, that's weird. I've never heard of one.
I haven't either. I'd be the Kurgan every single time.
I only like the first movie.
Well,
there
shouldn't be
crap.
The whole point of the first movie is that you could say this about the movie and the plot. There can be only one.
Yeah,
it's done. Like the plot of that movie is that it's finished. That's the whole plot of the movie.
There is, I'm not going to name any names, and you can pull this if you want, but there's a real hacky comedian that he's like a main guy, and I have no problem talking trash.
Feel free, talk trash.
I did this show, like he's a prop comic.
Okay.
I did this show, I begged to get on it because I've seen him online.
Right.
And just like in tears laughing at how cheesy this stuff
is. You hate watch or like... hate associate a lot with comedians.
I think I do. And so I had to be on the show because I wanted to see him live.
Yeah.
So I'm on the show, I do my thing, and he's headlining, and he has a bunch of bags of props, and one of them said Highlander on it. I'm like, oh, Highlander. Yeah, sure. I know Highlander. And he's like, oh, well, yeah, but that's not the movie, though. And I'm like, what do you mean? That's the logo for the TV show. TV show's the best thing they ever did with Highlander.
Oh, my dear God. There was a cartoon as well. Remember
there was.
Yeah.
And I'm like, oh, you're a big Highlander fan? He goes, am I a big Highlander fan? Pulls his sleeve up, Highlander tattoo.
He's
like, TV show logo.
Oh, my God. With he's Adrian, like, what's his name, was the Highlander on that? As McLeod.
Yeah, I can't remember the last name.
Yeah.
He's like, I love it. I've got all the swords. Best thing I've ever. And then he goes up on stage and puts on Chinese guy glasses and does the most racist stuff.
Oh, me Reiki Highlander. Yeah. Oh my God. I when I was in college, I was going to school to be a certified Avid editor, which was kind of what you people do on your phones now. But it was, you know, editing, you know, you could get a decent job as an editor for movies and TV.
Yeah.
And for my final, I had to take all the raw footage from an episode of Highlander the series and edit an episode together.
Oh,
and
that's...
But it was pain. I mean, was I had to watch tens and tens of hours of take after take of this show.
Right.
It was awful.
Editing is a thankless job. And absolutely. But if you're into it, it's a lot of fun.
Yeah, yeah.
But yeah, you're just, especially like that, you did that on video, right?
Yeah, it was video, yeah.
You know, before that stuff went on, made its way into computers.
It was Avid was the first non-linear machine.
Right, yeah. Right. That's a Massachusetts company,
yeah,
isn't it?
Yep, yeah, yeah.
People just going through the film, like watching it frame by frame.
Yeah.
In just forever.
Like, it was awful.
In a dark room.
When I went to school for audio, I learned how to do tape edits literally with razors and tape, tape together, which was really, you know, and if you wanted to do something, like you wanted to beep a swear, you'd have to cut the swear out and flip the tape and then tape it back in so the swear would be backwards.
Oh, cool.
And like that, but it was really weird.
Yeah.
It was very, very weird. I remember I saw Highlander in theaters with my dad.
Uh-huh.
And the beginning of that movie, which does actually have a really cool Queen soundtrack.
Yes.
But
yeah.
The first song is that Princes of the Universe.
Right.
And it starts off, here we are.
Yeah.
You know, but then this guitar kicks in that goes like,
yep.
My dad leans in and goes, yeah, all right. Yeah. Yeah. All right. Like he was like, yeah, I'm into it. All of a sudden.
It's like a big wrestling match too, isn't it?
Yeah, they're in Madison Square Garden.
Yeah. Yeah.
Born to be kings, we're the princes of the universe.
That's a great movie. Do you like that movie?
I love the first Highlander.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's a really cool movie. I actually like some things in the second movie. I wish it wasn't a Highlander movie.
Yeah.
It's kind of a cool post Blade Runner dumb movie, and I love Michael Ironsides, love Virginia Madison and anything.
Uh-huh.
It's just a stupid movie.
It's stupid. It's fun though.
The premise of it, where like the ozone broke and they have this dome on the whole, like, has nothing to do with Highlander and shouldn't, and is an interesting movie.
Yeah, yeah.
But the rest of it is garbage.
Yeah. Yeah, yeah. It's a tough watch.
So I'm watching that most of the night. Although there is a show on at 9 o'clock called To Live and Vie in L.A. Which sounds interesting, with Jennifer Garner in it, pre-Alias.
To Live and Die in L.A.,
There's a movie called To Live and
Die.
That's
why I know that. Yeah,
yeah, that has a great Wang Chung soundtrack.
Yeah.
So what are you doing at 9?
Oh, so we're on Wednesday?
Did Unsolved Mysteries for an hour on Wednesday?
Well, 9 was Forever Night.
Forever Night, that's right.
Yeah.
So you passed up the debut of Boston Set, Two Guys, a Girl, and a Pizza Place.
Oh, was that on that night?
That was the debut.
I almost lost a friendship because I was certain that, what's his name? Deadpool there.
Ryan Reynolds.
Ryan Reynolds was, I'm doing a real bad job with names right now. Local comedian, Dane Cook.
Yep.
I was like, same guy.
They're very similar, especially the character he plays in Two Guys and a Girl in a Pizza Place. Yeah.
I almost lost a friend over fighting over that. I was like, I'm sure it's, he's like, I'm like, no, that's the guy.
Yeah.
It's the same exact comedian. He's like, no, they're two totally different guys. I'm like, no, they're not.
Have you guys made amends?
At the time, but I haven't talked to him in years.
Okay, fair enough.
And it could be the spite boiled inside.
Here's the weird thing. The guy I got in the fight with was Dane Cook.
It was Dane Cook.
You were Ryan. I was never Ryan. You were for a couple of years. I had a huge, there's a lot of crush talk in this episode, but that makes sense because it's 1998. You know,
sure.
I'm 18 years old. Trailer Howard, who is the girl in Two Guys.
Same thing.
She was everywhere for like 2 years.
Yeah.
She was in Dirty Work. She was in this. She was in the show Boston Common.
Uh-huh.
And then just, I haven't seen her in anything.
Yeah.
Nothing.
Obviously this stuff is probably mostly shot in LA, right?
It absolutely was.
But it's set in Somerville.
Yeah, it's set in Somerville and it's supposed to be Peenie's Pizza.
Peenie's Pizza.
Which I always found humorous because their logo looks like penis pizza.
Yeah. was Boston Common also shot in?
Yeah, they're all three camera LA sitcoms. But what happened was you got a lot of people who went to Emerson.
Uh-huh.
And so they get out of Emerson, they go to LA and they're I'm going to pitch a show.
Yeah.
Hey, Boston.
Yeah.
And after Cheers ended, the networks were constantly trying to sort of recapture the magic of Cheers.
Uh-huh.
And I think a lot of the executives thought it was the Boston setting and not like the great writing and ensemble cast. They're like, I guess we'll try it again.
Yeah.
Something's going to work. And it just never worked. This is a pleasing slice of life sitcom about Boston pals in their mid-20s, Richard R. Ruccolo and Ryan Reynolds are Pete and Berg, grad students who work in a pizza joint and live in the same building as Sharon, a fiery sales rep. While Pete's an uptight architect to be, Berg's a carefree philosophy major who's often a guinea pig for product tests. These quirky, well-developed characters have strong appeal, as does a delusional patron played by David Ogden Stiers, whose life experiences like shark hunting are culled from a mishmash of classic films. In the opener, Pete wants to break up with his girlfriend, and Berg spills the beans.
Oh no.
Yeah.
I watched a few of those. I wasn't, like, too big on that show, though.
It was okay. I mean, they had a Halloween episode every year, which I was very excited about.
Uh-huh.
And I remember how big of a deal it was when they got rid of the pizza place in the title. And SNL had a pretty funny fake ad at the time that was a spinoff show called The Pizza Place.
Yeah.
That was the show that was just about the pizza place because they changed the name to two guys and a girl.
So
they just made a show called The Pizza Place. Yeah, it was pretty exciting. So Thursday night, 8 o'clock, would you go with? I assume you locked into must-see TV?
Thursday, no, I watched Alex Mack at 8 o'clock.
Okay. Speaking of crushes, I assume you had a crush on Larissa Alanick.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I did, yeah.
Yeah. I saw 10 Things I Hate About You that year because I enjoyed her. That show was always fun. Was really one of the last Nickelodeon shows I kind of got into. It got a little too young for me after that.
This year, this is 98, right?
Yeah.
This is when the Nicktoons started to fall for me. I wasn't a big fan of Two Angry Beavers and
right. Cat Dog.
Yeah, yeah. Not for me. I think I started to age out of it at that point.
Yeah, I think Rocko's Modern Life was the last one I got into, which was a second wave show. Or Real Monsters I liked.
Real Monsters was really good. Yeah,
yeah. I'm watching a thing called RSVP, The World's Funniest Party Disasters, which already is fantastic. It's hosted by Dave Thomas of SCTV fame.
Oh, although okay. They say I would Grace watch Under that. Fire,
hosts a compilation of video clips featuring mishaps from various celebrations, included birthday parties, bar mitzvahs, and graduations. I like that they've given us a rundown of what celebrations are.
Yeah, yeah.
But I'm watching that for
that's
the
that's pretty much every celebration right there.
Yeah, that's most of them. Yeah. Yeah. Are there any retirement parties? I'm not watching. 8:30, what'd you go with?
8:30, we're on Thursday. I wasn't sure what to watch.
Okay.
Most of these other ones, I was like, oh, I'll watch this, I'll watch that. So I was like, Just Shoot Me?
Yeah, with David Spade and Winnie Malick. Yeah. An okay show. People really loved it, but I was like, meh.
Yeah.
It was like a not as good news radio. Not nearly as good.
Have the guy that plays the dad in Veronica Mars?
Yes.
Isn't that, what's his name?
Nestor. Oh, no, her dad. Yeah, I can't think of his name.
It's like a Hispanic name.
Oh, Nestor.
He's a white guy.
Nestor
Carbonell, I think, is that. But that's
not
the guy.
He was on Suddenly Susan.
Oh, same show.
Yeah.
Same show.
Remember. Yeah. Caroline in the City?
Yeah.
Gymnastics is on.
Nah,
here's why it's exciting, though. It's called The Battle of the Sexes in Tucson, Arizona. I don't know why, but that kind of intrigued me. 9 o'clock, would you go with?
9 o'clock, I went with Multiplicity.
So you skipped Seinfeld.
Yeah, I mean, I like Seinfeld, but it was just with the choices that I had, I was, you know.
This is the one where Jerry's girlfriend looks ugly in some lights and pretty in other lights.
That's a funny
idea. Which is kind of funny.
I'm a big Seinfeld fan. I wasn't dodging it for any reason.
But you love Multiplicity.
At the time, I loved it, yeah.
Is that your favorite Michael Keaton movie?
No. What is my favorite Michael Keaton movie? Probably Beetlejuice.
Beetlejuice is good.
Yeah.
After Hours is good.
Oh, yeah. That's
Mr.
Really
Mom. Clean and Sober.
Mr. Mom was in the lineup for this, in this TV guide.
Johnny Dangerously. Mom, I think maybe John Hughes' first produced script.
Oh, really?
Yeah,
oh.
I think. Unless it was National Lampoon's High School Reunion. There's a made-for-TV movie on again called One Hot Summer Night. The Trophy Wife. The Millionaire Husband. The Hotshot Attorney. One will end up dead. Here's the great part. Erica Lanick from Baywatch is in it. Barry Bostwick is in it. Here's the weird thing.
I'm a big Barry Bostwick fan.
He's great. Christopher Darden.
I'm not sure.
He was one of the prosecuting attorneys in the O.J. Simpson trial.
So now he's an actor.
Apparently, Christopher Darden in his first starring role. What? I don't remember that at all.
That's pretty wild.
I guess,
believe it, though. I very much believe it.
I guess because him and Marsha Clark.
Yeah.
Basically, I had no career after that because they were like, you couldn't even convict this guy. Like, that's
yeah.
So it makes sense. And this is the murder of a rich sports magnate has a homicide cop suspicious of the man's cheating wife and her lawyer lover. Christopher Darden co-stars.
I remember the OJ trial made a lot of stars. And did Marcia Clark get anything like a clothing line or anything like that?
No, because she was, they brutally made fun of her on TV for her appearance. And then she lost the case. So they were like,
man,
you know, that whole thing was a freaking mess. So I'm kind of intrigued by that because that sounds like a wonderful car wreck. 9:30, did you go with anything or are you watching a whole hour of Multiplicity?
Yeah, I just, I couldn't see a lot of stuff I wanted on that
Veronica's
night.
Veronica's Closet. Yeah, there's nothing really on.
Yeah.
Friday night, the final night of the week, 8 all o'clock. Right. What'd you go with?
So this is another guilty pleasure. And I wrote next to this, and I didn't want to watch this, but I was curious about Jerky Boys. I've seen it.
The movie?
It's a really, it's a stinker.
It's real bad.
Yeah.
It is real bad. It might be, the only way that could have got worse is if it starred Christopher Darden. yeah, because I, like the Jerky Boys tapes, I was like, ah, these are funny when you're like 11 or 12.
When you're 11, yeah.
You listen to a couple times, and I'm like, no, not a whole movie.
Right.
And that movie sat on the shelf for a couple years.
Wasn't that produced by Sean Penn?
I think so.
He just liked them and
I guess,
here's a movie?
Yeah. He was like, I want you guys to star in this movie, I Am Sam. And they were like, no. And he was like, fine, you can do a Jerky Boys movie.
But I decided to settle with Beyond Belief, which is a guilty pleasure.
Yeah, and that was a show that was basically like Sightings, but with really bad reenactments. And they would come out first and say, one of these is garbage and the other two are real stories.
Yeah, and it's fun to pick which ones are real.
Beyond Belief, fact or fiction. Five stories, some of which are fictional, involving supernatural or unexplained events experienced by people in this special episode, all taking place on Friday the 13th.
Oh, yeah, this is Friday the 13th.
Yes, it is Friday the 13th.
I wrote another note on here, ? Friday the 13th marathon. Should I have just spent the whole night watching that, which I probably would have.
I generally would have. That's a good idea. And Friday the 13th is such a summer movie. By March, I really want it to be spring or summer. I would feel very summery to watch Friday the 13th.
Yeah, yeah.
What's your favorite Friday the 13th film?
My favorite is Part 6.
Yep.
Because it is like the most Friday the 13th out of the whole series.
It's the first one where he's a zombie.
Yeah, it has, bring him back to life with the spike and all that.
Alice Cooper, Man Behind the Mask.
Yep.
That is the best one.
Yeah, it is. And I recently was doing like a comedy-related thing where I was doing a commentary over it, and I noticed that there's no nudity in the movie.
In Part 6?
In Part 6, the version I watched on DVD, there's a sex scene, but there's no nudity.
But Part 5 has so much nudity because it was directed by Danny, what's his name, the guy that made, he made a bunch of porn movies.
Okay,
and he made that, what's that rape revenge movie that, from Exorcist, Linda Blair is in.
I don't know.
Oh, man, Street something. Anyway, he was like a real sleazy New York director, so there's like really graphic sex scenes in Part 5.
Is Part 5 the cop-out one?
Where it's not really Jason.
Yeah. That's always a bummer.
Yeah. Where they're at the home for disturbed kids. And
there's some messed up stuff.
The opening scene where the developmentally challenged guy gets killed with the candy bar in his hand.
Yeah, because they're fighting over a candy bar, right? Yeah.
Kid axes them to death.
Yeah.
Yeah, the inciting incident.
Yeah.
Yeah, Part 6 is fun. Like, Part 5 was so sleazy, like it just felt not that they feel classy or anything, but Part 6 was like a monster movie, like it was a fun and it has the opening that's like the parody of the James Bond credits, and because it's just a fun movie.
Right.
I love that movie. Tom Matthews from Return of the Living Dead is in it. Great movie. I probably would have watched that all night, to be honest. I'll always watch a Friday 13th marathon.
I honestly would have too. I just wanted to, you know, talk about stuff.
Beyond Belief.
Yeah.
Yeah. I normally also would have watched Sabrina at this time, a show that I enjoyed.
Sabrina the Teenage Witch?
Yes. Yeah.
I liked it. Yeah. Didn't Penn and Teller show up a lot in that?
They did.
Yeah.
Yep. As witches or like witch warlock thing. Yeah.
Yeah. They're in like another world.
Yeah. 8:30, what'd you go with?
Are
you watching a whole hour Beyond
Belief? Whole hour Beyond Belief. Yeah.
Did you go with Millennium at 9?
I didn't see Millennium was on there.
Oh, yeah, it is.
I would have gone with that. I was having trouble at 9 o'clock, so I settled for Dexter's Lab.
This is the final episode that aired of Millennium.
That was a big deal when that came out.
Yeah.
Because they knew the show was going to be canceled, right? So they had a actual resolution.
No. So here's the great thing about Millennium. They didn't. Chris Carter hedged his bet, because he was another one of those guys that was like a showrunner that could do no wrong.
Yeah, yeah.
And Millennium got such bad ratings and was such a dark show, which
but it was
I loved.
A good show.
It was a great show.
Yeah.
That they canceled it, and he ended it on a cliffhanger, being like, no, you can't. I ended it on a cliffhanger.
Smart.
And they were like, well, we just did. So they actually wrapped it up in an episode of X-Files.
Maybe later. That's what I remember.
Yeah, so it did get a conclusion, but it was later, which was frustrating. I loved Millennium. So if I wasn't watching Friday the 13th marathon, I'm watching Millennium.
And that has what's his name, who's in everything.
Oh yeah, from Aliens and Near Dark, Lance Hendrickson.
Yes, yeah, he's
from
in everything.
Pumpkinhead.
Yeah, yeah. The best credit.
So Mark, as you know, TV Guide, it's not just informative. It cheers and jeers. It has opinions. So I'm going to read you the cheers and jeers from this week, March 7th, 1998. See if you agree or disagree. It's a cheer-heavy week. We have 3 cheers, 2 jeers. So it's a happy week.
All right, good.
First cheer. Cheers to Karmic Coincidence. Two of the most original and entertaining comedies we can recall involving ornamental Indian wedding ceremonies.
Okay.
The Simpsons... and what's the other one? And Seinfeld. Okay.
Oh, is it? I remember that Pinter episode,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, yeah, so okay. Great for Indian weddings.
Yeah. Okay.
All
good.
Right. Yeah.
Good. A lot of people kind of laugh at Indian culture,
sure.
So it's a good turning
point. Yeah,
why
don't we laugh at them? jeers to over-familiarity. This season, many sitcom stars are bringing on their significant others as guest stars. On Friends, Jennifer Aniston did scenes with Tate Donovan. Tracy Pollan joined Michael J. Fox on Spin City. Kelsey Grammer gave Camille Dottarachi a cameo on Frasier. And Jennifer Love Hewitt recently turned up with Will Friedle on Boy Meets World. And on the latest Ellen, Anne Heche trades quips with Ellen. These indulgent stunts rarely result in real chemistry or laughs. But if there's a remake of Heart to Heart, we'll be sure to keep you kids in mind.
So this is a cheer?
That's a jeer.
That's a jeer.
Yeah.
Okay. Why is it a jeer? Just
they don't
because
like
they...
people having their significant other guest star on a show.
Okay.
Kind of stunt casting and indulgent.
Yeah, yeah. It's one of those things where it's just like, oh, you just got that because.
Yeah.
I get mad at that kind of stuff.
I met Anne Heche.
Is she cool?
Well, she was crazy.
She was.
I met her on September 10th, 2001.
Uh-oh.
In Harvard Square in the old book. Smith location.
You're not trying to blame her for anything,
she's,
are you?
She did 9/11. No, yeah. It was a place called Booksmith, which actually, have you ever seen the movie Girl Interrupted?
Yeah.
The woman who wrote that book, who went on a writer plays in the movie, used to work at this bookstore.
Okay.
In the 80s when I used to go there all the time. And Anne Heche had put out an autobiography the week before.
Okay.
And did a reading of this autobiography
on
that night. It was a Monday night, I think. Yeah, because 9/11 was
a Tuesday.
Yeah,
it was on a
morning.
Tuesday.
So she did a reading of this book. There was like 10 people there. So she just sat and talked to us for like 2 hours about how she believes she's an alien. Just like absolutely insane things.
Yeah.
And I remember going, I was working at WFNX, the radio station at the time, and I came into work that morning, and that's where we were talking about how crazy Anne Heche was. And then, and then 9/11 happened, and we didn't talk about it anymore. I bet she's so, because she kind of has come through that where no one really talks about that weird blip. Because I think 9/11 just was like a reset button for everybody. So people were like, remember that book Anne Heche put out where she thought she was an alien? That was an autobiography? People were like, no.
Yeah.
So she was like, oh, thank God.
I've been in those situations where there's like a reading or a signing and there's not a ton of people there.
Oh, many
times. And
it's
very depressing.
Yeah. Yeah.
I guess it shouldn't be. Like, the people are there to have fun and support what's going on, but it's just something about
it. You want
it.
A ton of people there.
Yeah.
Instead of being like, wow, I get them all to myself, you're kind of like, oh, I'm sorry.
Yeah.
I'm sorry you have to hang out with me.
Well, I guess I personally have been on that level, putting comedy shows together and promoting the hell out of it, and then 10 people show up.
Yeah.
You're like, oh, these are the people. These are the only ones that care
so
about me.
So you can sympathize. You can sympathize. So then we have cheers to those kinetic knights errant of rock, the Rolling Stone. In their Bridges to Babylon concert special, the Big Guns and PBS March Pledge Drive, the boys bring new sparkle to old gyms. All right, old man. I don't like the Rolling Stones.
I mean, I don't care one way or another. There's a couple good songs, but it's I don't own any of their records.
I like Paint It Black.
That's
a good song.
Was in my head. When,
Yeah.
And maybe that's it.
Yeah. And I like Gimme Shelter.
Yeah.
Gimme Shelter is one of my favorite songs of all time. Don't like anything else the Rolling Stones have done.
Yeah. They're just one of those things. It's like a snowball effect. They just got so big, you can't stop it. And
You can't ever stop them.
Yeah.
They're like Highlanders.
Yeah.
but the TV series. Jeers to losing perspective. We were surprised to see ESPN's Chris Berman and NBC's Ahmad Rashad turn up in a Gatorade commercial wobbling, "Like Mike, if I could be like Mike." Both men are ostensibly charged with reporting on the NBA and Michael Jordan, the league's biggest superstar. Obviously, their credibility and objectivity are compromised when they are featuring, when they are feathering their nests with Jordan's ad revenues. I like that jeer.
I have no take one way or another on that. Okay. Because I don't know. I know Michael Jordan. That's it.
Ahmad Rashad was married to Felicia Rashad of the Cosby Show.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, for a bit of time. And finally, cheers to timely topics. On a recent episode of the WB's Smart Guy, computer partial TJ and his young pal Karen meet someone in a kid's chat room who turns out to be an adult and a sexual predator. It's an effective cautionary tale for children about the dangers lurking on the web. Of course, the internet also has the potential for great merit. For instance, you can now email your cheers and jeers suggestions to us at cheersandjeers@tvguide.com. They used a plot about a web sexual predator to plug their own email address.
Good for them.
Wow. What a hidden show. I am at a loss for words at that.
That is pretty twisted. Did I have the internet at that time? 1998?
I got it in 94.
I don't think I had it.
Yeah.
I'm trying to remember if I don't think I did.
Yeah. Well, you could have emailed TV Guide to say, "Hey, I thought you hiding a cheers and jeers plug in your, hey, good job warning us about sexual predators article was a little bit in bad taste."
Yeah. That's a little twisted.
Yeah. I kind of appreciate the gall, especially after they had just chided those two guys for taking Gatorade ads.
I know. Come on, guys.
Yeah. They're not really taking a sexual predator TV show and turning it into a plug for their email address.
Yeah, that's pretty off. That's be like, what's that? Is it a Facts of Life episode where, not Facts of Life, where there's like a bike store owner.
Bicycle Man, starring Gordon Jump, was a two-parter Different Strokes episode.
Different Strokes.
Where Dudley gets molested, he makes him play a game called Neptune King of the Sea.
Do you think that TV Guide tried to sell bicycles off of that episode?
No, that would be terrible. Anyway, that's our show, so don't do drugs and email me at tvguidancecounselor@gmail.com, everybody. Well, thanks for doing the show, Mark. It's been great.
Yeah, thanks for having me. It's a lot of fun.
There you have it, Mark Gallagher, wonderful weirdo. As I said, Mark Gallagher's wonderful North Shore weirdo, as I would say if I still spoke like I did when I was a trashy 9-year-old. I've done my best to rid myself of that, but I think I may need some sort of exorcism to finally get rid of it. If you enjoyed the show, please rate and review it on iTunes. It is a huge help. And subscribe so you won't miss any shows. We do bonus content all the time. If you like me, which I hope that you do, but you know, it's fine if you don't. I do my best, but if you don't like me, that's fine. You can buy my album on iTunes. It's called The Vanity Project Volume 1 Hollywood Land, and I highly recommend. I like it. I'd buy it if I could, but legally I'm not allowed to purchase my own album. Anyway, we'll see you again next time on a brand new edition of TV Guidance Counselor.
Oh, would you mind if I killed you?
Yeah.